welcome to another exciting broadcast day.
Yes, it is. 866-901-ADAM. That's 866-901-ADAM. If you have any home improvement questions, give us a call. I just decided this is probably the time to do it when most people are sleeping, when I can focus one-on-one on your personal home improvement problem. Well, let's see. Sportscaster Rich Eisen is going to be calling in, talking about the Super Bowl. George Bush, I guess he's on hold, but we're not going to get to him until the 7 o'clock hour. So he's going to be calling in, telling us about the State of the Union.
The president.
Yeah. Wow. Well, that's what it says. It says President George Bush.
Yeah.
I can see.
Super Booker, Mike August.
Wow. I see he's on hold, but again, George, if you're listening, we'll get to you somewhere in the 7 o'clock hour. Dave interviews Joe Montana.
Who's Joe Montana?
Oh, yeah. I'm not going to dignify that with an answer. Dave, let's just continue with our show.
Move forward.
Yes. I think there's dignity in admitting ignorance.
Listen, if I was in your mother, Canada,
and you were in my mother.
Your mother.
Well, I should hope not.
If I was in your mother, I would pull out and go to Canada. And then, and I was sitting there watching Canadians speak, and you said, hey, later on we have our sports guy's interview with Guy Lepak. I would just be quiet.
Who's Guy Lepak?
I wouldn't say anything. That's my point. Exactly. Who's Guy Lepak? I don't know. I'm assuming you do. I'm assuming all of Canada knows who the great Guy Lepak is. Or Jacques Lestrap. One of the greatest greatest defensemen ever to strap on the blades.
I love to think what's going to happen with your children. Daddy, what's...
Well, that's just it. I'll cut them a break because they won't be in their 30s. They'll be born. Well, I don't know how it works chronologically, but I imagine you start at zero. And I'll do... you know what? I'll be appropriate. Because if they're like... 4 years old, and they're like, Daddy, who's Ponce de Leon? I'll explain. He was the guy who's looking for the Fountain of Youth. But if they're 30 and they ask the name of the president, I'll start laughing. And then I'll hit my wife.
I didn't ask you who the name of the president was.
Yes, what you did was much more egregious. Much more egregious. Super Bowl's coming up. The Super Bowl. One of the greatest champions in Super Bowl history. Little guy by the name of Joe Montana. Yes? Quarterback?
They named a state after him.
Yeah. He was so great. Yeah. We had 49 states, and then Montana hit the league. And then came the great state of Montana.
They didn't give him a very good state.
Well, what do you want him to do? Give him New York? The other ones were already spoken for. We just whacked off part of Idaho and gave it to him.
You whacked off Idaho. Who's that? Is that another guy?
First I was in your mom, and then I whacked off Idaho, I went to Canada.
He's another quarterback? This Mr. Idaho?
No, but it wouldn't be bad if we were making a movie. We're making a sports movie.
Yeah, we had Johnny Utah. Point Break.
Yeah. Loosely based on Montana. Retardedly based on Montana's character. All right. Where are we? Also, we got the Seattle mayor is going to be calling in. And I feel like, producer David Guest, Michael Jackson's friend, the one who married Liza Minnelli, will be in here. That will either be spectacular or a train wreck or quite possibly both. couple things. First off, we've talked about it before, but I did that thing where I went and walked my dog. I went home, took a nap, got up, took the dog for a walk, left, and there was a guy sort of merging with me as I was leaving my house, that sort of thing where he's walking and you're walking and you guys are sort of, you're two streams running into the same river. And I did that, how you doing? No audible response. And not wearing the headphones either. I understand and I appreciate, by the way, all the people that are exercising now with the headphones on. Everyone's got a Walkman. There's nobody, I shouldn't say Walkman, an iPod. There's nobody under 35 that does any jogging, any walking, anything that involves lower leg movement who doesn't have the earpiece in anymore, which is fine. You don't have to talk to them. But the old folks, they haven't caught on to this trend. They're not going to listen to Guy Lombardo when they're on their walk. And you don't want to do it. It's just you're both human beings and you establish eye contact. I don't want to say hi either. I wish he didn't see me. I wish I didn't see him. But I feel obligated as a citizen of the planet when I'm running into a guy who's walking into my neighborhood to go, "How you doing?" You know, it's not an enthusiastic embrace. It's not like he's come home from the war and I'm at the docks and I'm his lover. It's just, "How's it going?" Nothing.
Did he smile or nod or anything?
He heard me. There's that sort of like, there's that, you can tell the difference between when someone hears you and when someone doesn't, even if there's no response. You know, there's that sort of, I heard you, mm-hmm. look, not even a nod or a wave or thumbs back, up. Right. It's just, yeah, okay, I heard you.
Meantime, your two dogs are sniffing each other's genitals. He can't even do you the courtesy of a hello.
Right.
He was probably intimidated by you. He's probably even more shy than you are.
Maybe that's what it is. And people do that all the time. My wife will make that excuse for her shy friends. Oh, she's just shy. Oh, you just... Okay, just have her say hi then. Really? And by the way, if you can't handle that simple requirement of life, is there a place we could put you? You know, you always... That's why I always have... Dave will back me up on this one. I always have a, how you doing? And everyone should do this. How you doing? And F off. Have them chambered. Have them ready. Up on the shelf. Ready to go. Have them. You know the thing you do with the gun? You put the cartridge in and then you chamber. You chamber a bullet. Have it ready to go. Either F you. Someone could cut you off. Someone could yell something horrible. Or how you doing? Could be a neighbor that slides up on. Just have them chambered. You shouldn't have to search your mind for a how you doing.
Yeah, you do a nice job with them. You're sort of like the Lone Ranger with words. You have two six shooters on your left hip. You have the how you doing gun ready to fire.
Right.
But if you cross the ace man, you're ready to go to the right six shooter with the FUs.
Right. Well, that's the Derringer I keep in my sock, but it's always ready to go. Like so I catch someone cheating at a card game. Was there a card game in the Old West where somebody wasn't cheating immediately? And after a while, if you lived in the 1800s, would you just stop playing cards down at the local tavern? Because either you're going to get shot because someone's going to accuse you of cheating, or the guy next to you is going to immediately cheat. I've seen it. I've seen the movies. There was no card playing without cheating. Jillian?
Adam.
What's happening, baby doll?
I'm just driving into work. I don't know how you guys do it every morning.
I don't know how you do it. You do it all night? You do it in the morning? You do it in the afternoon?
I wish it's been a long time since I've done it all night.
Really? You're from Canada, yes?
Yes.
Do you know who Joe Montana is?
Of course.
Okay. I'm just checking.
I didn't blame it on the fact that I'm Canadian.
Like, I do. I think it is.
I blame most of my ignorance on that, but not this time. I just blame that on the fact that I didn't care.
All right.
But I cared enough to ask.
No, that's
true.
You're
younger, too, right?
Yeah, I mean, she's younger, a baby. So. She's a baby.
Yeah. That'll do it.
Jillian, I watched a show, as I do religiously. I watched it Monday night. You skated your took eye off, and you did a wonderful job. And again, the judges were tough on you.
They hate us.
Well, they hate you because you know what you're doing, and you're going up against people that oftentimes have a few weeks experience when you grew up on the ice, or so it looks to the layperson. So I think they're being tough on you. And as a matter of fact, I think they need to pursue that angle for ratings, because if they just said clearly you're the best in the group, the competition would be over.
Exactly. Right. And they're judging us according to our skill level that we came in with. And if we've improved from there, it's hard for me. I mean, I'm not going to be able to go out there and land jumps or doubles and stuff, but I think I've improved a little bit even from when I first put the skates on, because it had been so many years. I mean, I found out on a Thursday and I was on the ice on a Monday.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you're 39, it's a little different than when you were 14 and you did it for fun after school. It's very different. And I can't, I'm doing my best, but they are really hard on us. And there are times you're just like, well, what's the point? Why am I even in this? And they're just,
well,
I had so much fun at the same time.
Yeah, but see, you're damned if you do and damned if you don't. Because if you go out there and start nailing the triple cow sow hill bills, you're just, well, I could hang out with you. I let gas go. Jillian erupts into laughter.
I find it very amazing.
Well, good.
I was listening to you talking about the guy in the street. I had a full, first of all, when I get on a plane and the person beside me pulls out a headset, makes Jillian a happy person. I get
it's
very
nice.
Excited.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had a whole conversation the other day at the magazine stand with a guy that knew me. It was one of those fake 5 minutes. He goes, oh, my God, Jillian, Marissa had her baby. I said, okay, obviously this guy knows me and I know his wife. I go, wow, when? 2 days ago, congratulations. Wow, he must be busy, he must be tired. Oh, no, baby sleep, it's great, everything's great. God, you're doing good. I go, yeah, well, you know, keep him busy. I go, So life's treating you good. A full 5-minute BS conversation. Have no idea who he is.
Yes.
He says, I can't complain. I go, yeah, me neither, because nobody would listen. It was one of those completely irrelevant conversations. And I got in my car and I said, what are you doing? You don't even know this person. Why can't you just be honest and say?
Well, the greatest... Your greatest fear in life is talking to someone and having them realize you don't know who they are and can't remember them. I don't know why you go through life in fear. I don't, you know what's a weird thing? I don't like going places with my wife that involve work because for that one reason, because there's going to be 80 people whose names I can't remember who I'm going to have to introduce my wife to, except for I can't remember their name. So I don't want to go with her because if I go solo, it's, hey, dude, hey, bro, what's up? Hey, champ. Champ, looking good, champ. Start with a compliment. You're right out of the
what's
water.
What's my name?
Hey, listen, sweetie.
Governor.
Governor.
Governor. I used to say to my husband, I'm not going to remember anybody's name, so just reach your hand up first and go, hi, I'm Brett, Jillian's husband.
Believe me, I go through that wasted conversation with my wife on the way to the K-Rock concert each and every year. Would you please not stand just a little bit behind me and pout because I'm not introducing you to this guy who's in the band I can't remember. Step up and introduce you. And then she gets angry every time. Then we drive home. You didn't introduce me. I don't know the guy's name. I told you they don't do it.
How come it is that we can remember the nicknames that we give people, like Sloppy and Harry and whatever, but we can't remember their actual names?
Well, I'll tell you why. Because their name, I'll tell you, you can remember their name if they look like their name. But if they don't, if there's a huge muscular guy who's a tan and buff and his name is Harold, you can't remember it. But if it's Duke, you remember it. And the nicknames are like the names they should have been named.
Right.
And that's how it's, and it's, there's names, there's guys you can remember, even just straight names. There's Big Tad. No one forgets Big Tad's name. Tad looks like Big Tad. Tad's, the word Big's right in his name. It's right on his license and you don't forget it. But once in a while, there's somebody who doesn't look like who they're supposed to be and you'll never remember that name.
And somehow you don't get credit for when you just remember the letter that their name begins with.
Yeah.
Hey, M. It big M.
This is why. See, we have dude, but that's thinly veiled. The blacks have dog. I suggest we take that.
Hey, man.
The hippies have man. All I'm saying is, please don't put us into that position where we have to remember your name. And then the other thing is, what about this person? You ever get this guy? I call my friend Don, and his mother-in-law will be house sitting. Now, the last time I spoke about this, she was crushed and was angry that I brought it up, but I'm bringing it up again. She picks up the phone and just answers, hello? This is the person who goes to somebody else's house. Maybe they're watching the kids. Maybe they're house sitting. Whatever it is. They pick up the phone and they don't say Brown residence or Johnson residence or this is Connie's mom. They answer, hello? And then there's that weird pause where you're on the other line.
You hang up.
No, is it weird? Kathy? No. Okay, now I'm reeling. My world is rocked. You have to announce. Could you imagine going to someone else's house and just picking the phone up and answering it? What is that? I would like those people put in a corner of hell with the guy who doesn't say hi or wave or do anything when you walk up to him.
I like that guy doesn't acknowledge. Just keep walking. And because sometimes even if they don't know, like for you, your voice is very distinctive like mine. If I start talking, especially if I'm in a store, with, like my friends will be at Barnes & Noble and they call me something else all the time. Because if Jillian's exact, you go, oh, is that that? Oh, yeah. That. And then people go, hey, you're shorter in person. Or, hey, why don't you see that on the air today? I don't. I just want to be alone. I want to read my magazine.
Yes.
I don't want to. So
I'll tell you what. We should hook up so we can be alone.
See, you're married already. I want a single guy who has great sense of humor, who's fun.
Well, you got Big Tad over here.
I
could bring my wife, except for I won't be able to remember your name.
I still got 2 weeks.
Sheck's single for another 2 weeks. Well, we don't have to get it on, Jillian. We could just hook up and then go to separate parts of the room and be alone.
I already got enough guy friends. They're all good. You know,
I've
got guy friends. I want a guy that I'm potentially going to hang out with.
Well, what are you? What? You're single. You're not dating anyone.
No, I'd like to, but...
You'd like to. And what...
I'd love to go. I would love to be involved in something. Yeah.
All right, let's break this down for a second, because I think there's a lot of women, especially, and guys, too, who do that thing where they're like, well, you know, I'm not dating anyone because guys can't handle me. They're intimidated by me. But it's not so much intimidated sometimes as it is frightened. Your ball of energy that's coming at them, and guys recoil. They freak out.
Yeah, but I'm not always. I'm only like that on the air. Most of the time, I'm very quiet at home. Can you imagine if I was a ball of energy running around my house like a lunatic with my dogs? I
mean, right. All right. So
institutionalized. What? No, I like just honestly simple, like dinner, movie. I love movies. I go like twice a week to the movies.
What do you think is the big issue?
Wish I knew. Yeah, I don't need the guy to make a ton of money. I don't care. As long as he's happy doing what he does. I don't care if he's a carpenter or he races cars. Could care less.
I know. Everyone says that, but then we read in the paper 6 months from now that you married the Sultan of Brunei. That's what we're going to read. We're not going to read you met a guy who does appliance repair. It'll be the Sultan.
I really don't care.
You really don't care? Well, then, if you don't care, Mike August is the man for you, because he doesn't care either.
Is he cute?
He's cute.
I need to be attracted. If I'm not attracted,
he's
got problems.
He's cheap, Jillian.
Rachel can't do. I'm not going down that road.
All right,
again.
But
I took care of a man before, and I will not do it again. I paid alimony. I'm not going down that road.
I love that. I want you to picture if Fred Ward couldn't book guests. That's kind of what he would be. Just close your eyes and picture Fred Ward with no Rolodex, and then you have Mike August. Yeah.
Looks like Fred Ward.
Yeah, he does.
Like Fred Ward, he's cute.
Well, yeah, but he also who else is he?
Katie Lang.
He also looks like Katie Lang.
He's a lot stronger resemblance to Katie Lang.
All right, but if a dude has to look like
she is a handsome woman.
I'm saying if a dude has to look like a chick, Katie Lang is the one.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He doesn't look like you don't want Eartha Kitt.
I was just thinking about this because I'm pulling into Fox. Did you see Christy smash her face last night?
Yes.
That was something.
Well, here's the thing. We're talking about skating with celebrities Monday nights on Fox, 8 p.m. Jillian Barberie on the line. Christy Swanson whacked her chin. She grazed it during practice, and then she whacked it. And here's what I realized. Christy Swanson is built for speed. She is not a flyweight. I'm trying to be kind, and I'm not trying to make excuses. She's not fat. She's not overweight, but she looks like she's 135, 140 pounds. She's a strong, solidly built woman, and her partner is used to throwing around a 100-pound person. Now her partner has an extra 40 pounds on there, and he's spinning her around, and he can't handle it. So
he's actually one of Lloyd Eisen is known for his strength back in Canada. He is probably one of the strongest pair skaters, and I think that's why they put them together. John, my partner, wasn't known for his strength, but I'm still heavier than his partner. Kyoko Ino is like 95 pounds.
Well, I mean, that's my point. No matter how strong you are, if you're used to doing the stunt with a 100-pound girl and now you have a 140-pound girl, her chin may hit the ice.
I could handle her.
Oh, you'd handle it, but good.
I'm not known for my strength. I'm known for my sensuality.
Yes. Yeah. Did she require stitches? Did she need?
No, she didn't get stitches, but she had a nice number on her chin. Next week, I think I rack my rib cage and Bruce splits his face open. But you know, it was constant injuries and stuff. But I realized it was just so worth it anyway. Like, I look back and I look at these shows. I watch it at the Jenners every Monday night, and they're saying, God, those judges are kind of brutal on you. And I said, you know what? They have to be. You're absolutely right, Adam.
It would be boring because your skill level. Although now we have Coulier left, who did pretty good with Kerrigan, and this thing's going to heat up. We got to take a break, Jillian. Thanks
for
calling in.
You guys have an awesome day. I'll talk to you again.
You too.
She's going to win anyway.
I love it. She's really good, and her partner's really good, and they're really good together, and the show's fun.
She plays it close to the vest, but I think we all know she's the winner, right?
Otherwise, she'd be angry right now.
Yeah, that's true.
Because she'd think, well, I got beat by somebody who wasn't as good as me. Skating with Celebrities Monday nights on Fox, 8 o'clock. Non-technical construction question. Basic plumbing question. We got to take a break. All right. Hang on. Well, we'll go to break. We'll go to break. I'm just saying, hang on to the listeners. We will answer a couple home improvement questions. And then, what's after that, Preska?
We figure we do check in on Big Fat Tad. He's got a big weigh-in tomorrow.
And then
we have George Bush calling.
Oh.
We have Seattle Mayor calling in.
Got it.
We got David Guest coming in.
All right. After this.
Sad whispering in the trees.
101.
Listen to Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901 Adam.
Yeah. 866-901 Adam. You know, I was thinking sound is getting too good and it's starting to screw with us like it does my dog. There was a little turbulence on that drop. Big Tad was moving his mic the whole time that thing was happening, and I was about to yell Big Tad to knock it off, and I realized that wasn't coming from there. But I'm now becoming fooled because I have the surround sound system, and if I'm watching a TV show and someone's cell phone rings on the TV show, I stop and get up and look around. I'm becoming my dog now. My dog hears chains rattling and starts barking at the TV set. And I laugh my ass off. Look at you, stupid beast. Look at you. That's not so dog. Where's the doggy, Mom? Where's the dog? Starts barking. 10 minutes later, I'm sitting there. A phone rings on a TV show I'm watching. I put it on pause and get up and walk into the kitchen and then stand there for 10 minutes and then come back down.
There's a doorbell on a Pizza Hut commercial that gets me every time.
Yeah. By the way, I don't know who's going to get involved with this. The FCC is so busy worried about... me saying something filthy on the air that they don't focus on the real important stuff, which is that stuff. Like sometimes they play it in commercials and you're driving your car and there'll be a car honk, there'll be a horn honk, or there'll be a cell phone ring. Whatever it is, it's probably caused an accident or three. I could have went in my kitchen, slipped on something and died. And that's where they would have found me.
Well, and high def television too also is also too good. Exposing what we once thought the beauty of our matinee idols now being exposed.
Yes.
As humans.
That turns out. Marks. Yeah. It turns out Jennifer Aniston is a pig. Mm-hmm. A pig. Thank you. Jason?
Yo.
But she's learning to love again. That's the good news. You have a question about home improvement? Because I'm here to answer.
Yeah, I mean, I got a quick little plumbing question this bright early morning.
Good. Well, first, let's hear our theme song. Do we have our home improvement theme song, Mike?
Teddy Bear. If you want to ask him a question about home improvement, mm-hmm. how to put up some drywall, or how to find a stud, call Adam now.
Call Adam now.
They help you fix up your house. Before you nail your hand to a freaking 2x4, or cut off your love gland with a reciprocating saw, call Adam now. Help you fix up your house.
Wow.
Help you fix up your house.
I'm going to try to confuse Rachel Perry even more. Sung by the King, Joe Montana.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Jason, big fan?
Yeah. That's okay. He's so cool.
You got all the Montana records?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Jason?
Hey.
All right. So what is your question?
Well, the thing is, I got two bathrooms. I got the spare bathroom and the master bathroom, and they're both sort of on the same wall. You know, mm-hmm. they're kind of behind each other. One's on the, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I don't like master, by the way. I don't like what that term connotes, you know. maybe I'm from California, maybe I'm a little PC, but I'm just not comfortable with master bedroom, master bath. I like slave owner bathroom. I just find it more palatable. You know, I'm kind of a left winger. That's me. But go ahead.
I'm from the East Coast. It's a little different.
Okay, all right. Well, you guys do what you want over there. Live in the Stone Age. See what I care. So what's the question?
Well, the toilets seem to be interacting with each other.
Mm-hmm.
In the sense that, like, the spare bath...
Are they breeding?
Yeah. No, it's like when chicks work in an office long enough and they start syncing up their periods. Toilets will do that if you put them in the same house. Yeah. Sympathetic flushers. Things like that. Yeah. I'll have a toilet that'll flush when there's no Duke in it just because.
Yes, I don't know if there's a ghost in the house, but sometimes when I flush one toilet, it'll cause the other toilet to want to refill its basin for like 30 seconds or 15 seconds.
Well, the other toilet's not going to refill unless something comes out of it because it's got that float. It's got that float in the back of it in the tank, right? So they're hooked up to the same 4-inch main line that's leaving the house. You know, one of them's going in and the other one is whying into it or teeing into it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So obviously when you flush one and it passes the other, it might create some sort of vacuum that draws something out of the bowl and then it has to refill its tank a little bit. I'll bet you it's the one that's furthest away from where the main is, from where it hits the street. What I'm saying is if you flush the one that's farthest away from the street, the other one may do something. If you flush the one that's closer to the street, the far away one's not going to move. What do you think?
It's actually the exact opposite.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Thanks for calling. See, that's how you do it. You just make it your idea. Idea for remodeling life?
Question we just fix it. We added it and fix it.
All right. Let me talk to, we'll get that in post. Dick?
Yep.
What's happening, my brother?
Hey, kitchen remodel, hardwood cabinets versus hardwood floor. Mm-hmm. Cabinets are all solid hardwood. Naughty Alder.
Naughty Alder. That was my porn name. Naughty Alder to the set. All right, let me chub up. Yeah.
1920 Craftsman. The wife wants Mexican pavers. I'm thinking hardwood. 2-inch. Mm-hmm. Maybe straight Douglas fir. The old style.
Uh-huh.
The houses that couldn't afford the oak.
Okay, well, let me tell you what's going on in the 20s. That T&G clear dug fir, which is closer to a true 1-inch, and it's it's probably 1x3. That stuff was the original subflooring in kitchens and a lot of bathrooms before they had particle board and plywood.
And it's existing now.
You want to refinish that?
Yeah.
I'm going to change your life, Dick.
Let's go.
Well, I don't think I've ever said that. I'm going to change your life and then... followed it by the name Dick.
Don't be scared.
You need to peel. Have you peeled off the vinyl?
No, it's still down, but I can see the subfloor.
All right. It's beautiful. You're going to get to it. It's going to be a mess. And everyone's going to tell you to go ahead and go over it with something. You should patch it. You should sand it. And then you should paint it. Don't stain it. Paint it and then put a coat of Varathane over the paint. I've done it in my own home.
Okay.
Who's seen it? How marvelous does it look?
Gorgeous.
What color?
I painted mine a sort of a burgundy color. I did a trim around it. I did the whole thing, and then I covered it. It looks beautiful, but there's going to be holes. You got to repair those holes. You can repair those. You know how to repair the holes?
Yeah.
How?
You fill them.
No S, Sherlock, but how? With what?
Oh, come on.
You got nothing.
I got you.
Okay. Do you really have a floor? Do you really have the TNG, clear TNG Doug Fir?
The TNG is existing over the wire.
All right. Listen to me. Don't crack wise. I'll hang up on your ass. You need to fill it with a Dutchman. You understand?
No.
Okay. You have a hole in your floor, right?
I've got several.
Yes, you need to take a router and you need to mortise out a groove like a slot where a hinge goes in the door.
Okay.
And then you take a thin piece of wood and you snap it over the hole. And then you sand the whole thing down when you sand the floor with a drum sander and you can't see the hole anymore. Don't fill the hole. Cover the hole. Okay.
Burgundy.
Yeah, all right. All right. I never know. You know what's weird? Here's the thing, everybody. We should make this law. There's many laws. One, do not introduce yourself to me at a concert. Two, if I say hi to you, at least nod and wave your hand. And three, if you're joking, be funny. Or I don't know you're joking. I have a lot of sort of half-joking conversations with people where about 3/4 of the way into it, I think to myself, oh, wait a minute, this guy's he's putting me on. But if he is putting me on, have it be funny or interesting or something. You know what I'm saying?
Can't all be you, Adam.
Make a joke. I wouldn't like it to be you. I don't want it to be me. But if you have a legitimate home improvement question, I would love to answer it. If you don't and you just have a goof, by all means, have a goof. But if you're going in between, I don't know what we're talking about anymore.
Right.
Now, I don't know. We've talked to this guy for a few moments. I have no idea if he actually had this question or he didn't. it seemed like he did for a few beats, but then he would make a joke, and I wasn't sure if he was listening or not. All right. Someone's impressed with me. I'm going to take that call every time. Ty?
Yes.
What's happening, my man?
Hey, I just wanted to say I'm sorry about this morning. I was just starstruck. I would have said hi.
What happened?
That was
yesterday in the afternoon. But thanks, Ty.
No, I just wanted to say I was impressed. Yeah, that's exactly what's going on with that guy's toilet. I'm a plumbing contractor. I own a plumbing company, and that's got to be it. You know, that water sits in the tap bowl there, and as it passes through the bigger pipe, something's going to spill out and cause it to refill.
Thank you, Ty. God love you. Not even a plumber. God bless you.
Yeah, that was pretty good.
All right, you can be our official plumber if you want.
Excellent.
Thank you. Someone's building a retractable bed. Brusca looked at the clock. That's always a bad sign. Kyle?
Yeah, how you doing?
What are you building?
I'm trying to build a Murphy bed. Something that folds out. Mm-hmm. Usually they're in the wall, but I'm trying to build one. It's an exterior shell for my apartment.
Mm-hmm.
Any suggestions?
Don't. That's where they'll find your rotting corpse trapped somewhere in between because you used a spring hinge system from a garage door opener and you got trapped and then you just died of sleep deprivation and water deprivation. Seems like a tall order.
That hasn't happened in a long time in sitcom. You know, it used to be the plot of many sitcoms, the guy getting flung back in the Murphy bed and being trapped in there.
Well, I'm a bigger guy. I mean,
you can hold it down. Yeah, are you a decent carpenter?
Yeah, I have some experience.
All right, well, what's your question, though? You want to know how to build it?
Yeah, like an idea for a hinge or something to make it go up and down.
I'll tell you, I know it sounds like I was kidding, but the only thing I can think of that's analogous is looking at some of that garage stuff.
Huh.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Well, it's the same thing that does your garage door, makes a garage door go up. It's just sort of inverted, if you think about it.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I will.
All right. Yeah, you see, we learned our lesson because I grew up watching TV where a guy would fold a Murphy bed down, sit on it, it somehow get released and get flung into the next county or just smashed up against the wall. And it's the same thing where I'd watch Charlie's Angels and the angels would go into the sauna and then the nefarious guy would come up and turn it from warm to skull and crossbones. You know, triple a red, you know, this will kill, like 750 degrees. It will kill a human. It will roast a turkey in here. And I think at some point, manufacturers started thinking, maybe there's too much liability. If you manufacture Murphy beds and the strings have 250 foot-pounds of torque on them, which is way more than you need just to fold the bed back up safely, maybe we ought to dial it down. And same thing with the guys who manufactured saunas. Maybe it should just go up to 130 degrees, what a human being could take. But if we could roast the turkey, there's probably some liability there. So let's just... And by the way, it costs us more to have the thing go up to 750 degrees. So I think we learned our lesson. I miss those days, but we learned our lesson. All right, so Rich Eisen is going to be calling in. Big Tad is going to be doing the state of our show. Also, he's going to be getting on the scale tomorrow. Yeah. 12 and a half pounds, my brother.
He's got to be 308 and a half.
Get your gun ready.
308 and a half. Oh, yeah, we got to get a paintball gun. All that. The King. Joe Montana. Hey, dig this song, everyone. This is one of the King's best. It really is. Rarely gets played, but it's one of his best. All right, we'll be back. And Marie's the name of his latest fame. Yes, and that's who's listening. 866-901-ADAM. Rich Eisen is on the horn. He is... of course, the anchor of NFL Network's Total Access, which I watch religiously. Rich is in Detroit City right now, getting ready for the Super Bowl. I'm going to put him on in 1 second. Let me just talk to Caroline. Caroline?
Yes, hi.
You're remodeling a bathroom?
Yes, we are.
Yeah, you and your husband.
Well, my husband's doing it. I'm in charge of cleanup.
All right, you have a question?
Yeah, we did the hot mopping in the shower, and we put up all the Hardy Backer, and I'm just kind of trying to guesstimate.
Hot mopping, all right, quiet down. Hot mopping's the tar you put on in the shower pan so it does not leak because the tile is not waterproof and neither is the grout. And the Hardy Backer cement board that you put on the wall in lieu of floating it to take the tile. Thank you. Keep going.
And how long does it take after that? What comes next?
Put the hardy backer on the wall, which is a cement board. Then you whip up the thin set. And
the what?
You put, thin set. It's what you put the tile on with. You put the tile right onto the hardy backer.
All right.
All right. And I, right. I would mix that thin set up with a little acrylic. Makes it more durable.
Uh-huh.
Put it on with a notch trowel, and then put your tile on. And then grout, and you're done.
That's it?
Yeah.
Good. I get them out of my bathroom.
Yeah. It's still 2 years away, knowing your husband. He's drunk right now at work, probably on top of his secretary. But
probably
if he had one. Here's the point. All right. And please don't ask me if I actually know this stuff off the air. It's always insulting. People do that all the time. They go, I hear you talking about all that home improvement stuff. Do you really know what you're talking about? I always go, well, I don't know anything about computers. How long do you think I could keep that bluff up if somebody called and asked me about computers? All right. Who'd I punch up? Oh, Rich?
Yes, sir.
What's happening? Thanks for calling.
He has some home improvement questions.
You bet. Yeah, actually, it was funny. Somebody at yesterday's media day asked Ben Roethlisberger about hot mopping, and he was able to BS his way through it for about a minute.
Wow.
He's very impressive.
What can't number seven do?
I haven't seen it yet.
One more reason. You haven't found what he can't do, have you?
Nah. You know, he's really played beyond his years ever since the beginning, and that's just another example of it.
I'll tell you, it is. It keeps being brought up. You see, well, he'll be the youngest quarterback, you know, dethroning Tom Brady, which I'm keeping my fingers crossed for. I somehow want him to knock Tom Brady off his young guy throne and be the youngest quarterback, but I'd like to see Seattle win simultaneously, so I have to work that out. Work it out. I'd like Bettis to get the win. I would like Roethlisberger to be the youngest quarterback to win a thing. And I would like Seattle to go home with a victory. So I'm going to...
Well, you know the old adage, Adam, is that you know, if you play this game 10 times, someone's going to win it 6, someone's going to win it once or whatever. So maybe that's the way they have to do it.
Yeah,
here at Super Bowl Extra Large. But I think you also hit on something that both these teams are extremely likable, that there's really no...
there's no villain.
Bad guy. There is no villain in this game. No, there is none.
I know. And right now, it just really comes down to whose DB is going to get stabbed by their wife moments before kickoff. Because
you know that is definitely the overlooked, I guess.
That's a wild card
twist, wrinkle. If
oh
you will,
yeah, don't worry. You're not
postseason.
You're not going to lose a punter or a holder, but you always have to carry an extra DB when you go to the Super Bowl. But figure one of them's going to get jabbed with a sewing pin by the old lady.
Yeah, and then pick up the key fumble in the last minute of the game and get tackled. That, quarterback.
That would be part of my prenup if I was a DB who was entering the league and going to get married. If, in fact, our team does make the Super Bowl, you'll have to wait till after the Super Bowl to stab me.
Yes, no pregame stabbing allowed. That's a very rare prenup clause. I would agree. That would be wise to get placed in there. Yes.
The other thing, too, is when are these guys going to learn their lesson and not pick up the phone and dial 911 when they do get the jab with the pin? You know what I mean? Like, all right, so it's the Friday before the Super Bowl. You and the old lady get into a blowout, and she stabs you with a sprinkler key. Take yourself to the hospital and say you fell in the garage.
Walk.
Drag your gimpy leg to the hospital and get it sutured, but don't call 911. It's all over the paper the next day.
You're hitting on some very key points for Super Bowl 40 right now.
Thank you.
Keys to the game. Very key to the game here. Absolutely.
Please, could you have the Wavos to bring that up on your show?
I also think it's key to avoid the hookers.
Try to avoid the hookers.
We've been through that. That's well-traveled ground.
Right.
Certainly before you win the Man of the Year Award, the Walter Payton Man of the Year Award, which is what happened that very weekend. Yeah.
Oh, Eugene Robinson won the award, and then
you should definitely self-imposed curfew.
Was that believe. Where was it? Was that New Orleans?
Oh no, I believe
Miami.
Miami.
Yeah, well, Miami, they shouldn't have Super Bowls in New Orleans or Miami, or if they do, fly them in that day. don't hang out for a week in a suite without your wife.
Yeah, that was Terrell Davis's last Super Bowl.
Yeah,
the Broncos beat the Falcons in Miami.
What, Rich? More importantly, what am I and we going to do when this season ends? And I know we're all looking forward to the big day Sunday, but I feel a sort of depression that is overwhelming after the Super Bowl.
Well, I mean, we're here for you, Adam. I mean, we're taking off day after the Super Bowl to Kauai. I think I'm going to be the first guy to go from Detroit to Honolulu since Magnum P.I.
Right.
and then after that, we've got the Combine at the end of the month, if that interests you. I mean, it is interesting sort of behind-the-scenes look at how...
It's a little methadone. It's a little methadone to my football heroine, but...
Well, you're not going to get games. I mean, that's not...
What's wrong with showing old Monday, vintage Monday Night Football? I bring it up every time, but what about it?
I don't know. I mean, we've sort of looked into it. The last time we chatted about it, I don't think it's...
How about this, Rich? How about this? How about we get college football to start in February? So we can have our pigskins year-round.
Yeah, sure.
Huh? Well, what about it?
NFL Network.
Wait a minute. This year, because of the World Cup, so as not to obviously clash or take away from that big event, NFL Europe has pushed its schedule up to start in March.
I don't want to see a bunch of guys that look like they're extras from an Oliver Stone movie running around the field in jerseys I don't recognize, though, you know?
Rhineland. But hey, I mean, you never know. I mean, Kurt Warner, Jake DeLome, Adam Vinatieri, they all played.
Yeah, before you heard of them, so it doesn't count. That's the point. If I had a time machine, it would be exciting, but right now it's just some nameless, faceless guy who I don't recognize wearing a jersey with a LeFleur on it or something, whatever that weird
Fleur-de-lis
on it. Yeah, what the hell?
If you think you sound so smart BSing about hot mopping, think about, you know, hey, I used to see so-and-so play for the...
Amsterdam Admirals, Kurt Warner.
Kurt Warner, and there you go, Admirals, Amsterdam. It doesn't, and it's weird seeing a bunch of black guys running around in Amsterdam. It feels strange.
For the Rhine Fire, you know. I mean, come on. It starts in March. So
just all right. Let's get Monday night. Start focusing on Monday Night Football.
But Eisen, you must be on cloud nine because you guys are going to be broadcasting actual NFL games.
Yeah, that's a true story.
Come fall.
Oh, that's right. Monday Night Football.
Is Rich going to do the play-by-play?
Listen, we just found out 5 days ago we've got 8 games in 2006. It starts almost every Thursday and Saturday, starting with Thanksgiving.
That's awesome.
Night.
And, but that's in addition to Detroit and Dallas. There will be a third Thanksgiving game?
Yes, there will.
That's awesome.
Wow.
It's going to be basically, so now nobody has to talk to family for the entire day.
That's awesome. Well, I've already talked to my wife. She's going to go ahead and put me under. I'm going to have an IV drip and a diaper, and I'm just going down for 8 months. I thought it'd wake me up like a bear.
Excellent.
Rich Eisen, everyone. Thanks for calling in, Rich. We do appreciate it. The NFL Network, NFL Total Access. I watch it religiously. And the great Rich Eisen from Detroit. All right, we will take ourselves a break. We'll be back with Tad's State of the Union and news and sports and much, much more after this.
Hey, it's the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam Carolla now, 866-901-ADAM.
Yeah, what a pro, 866-901-ADAM. All right, well, State of the Union... We was on 5 networks, and I still managed to miss about 95% of it. I'm just angry. Does it have to be on every network?
That's how I always feel.
I wanted to watch my Entertainment Tonight, my Extra, and all my other crappy, fluff-filled shows last night. And I couldn't because Bush was up there filibustering. And I thought, I understand it needs to be covered, although I'd be fine if they had no cameras in the place. But if so... One network, good enough. I mean, how does it work with other things? The Super Bowl. Shaq, how many networks is the Super Bowl going to be on?
Only one.
Which one?
ABC.
ABC, I guess I'm going to miss it then. I'm an NBC man. No, I'll switch the channel, and then I'll switch back. That's how I'll do it. Isn't that how it works?
Yeah. For your own sake, for the network's sake... How about loop some Simpsons or Seinfeld reruns? I guarantee you, you'd end up doing better than the ones covering the State of the Union.
Well, if it was one network covering the State of the Union, maybe you wouldn't beat them. But if you're going to whack that pie up into 10 different pieces, how big is your piece going to be? You would pull better numbers just showing a hee-haw rerun. That's what they ought to do. Take a stand. You get a lot of coverage.
Of course,
out of
if
it.
You're the network who gets the highest ratings. That shows the exact same thing as any other network. Yeah. You really have to feel good about yourself.
And that would be the gist of my campaign when I was talking to advertisers. We all carried the State of the Union. We had a higher rating than all our competitors. What's that say about us? The exact same content. And by the way, not funny. Villaraigosa, the mayor out here in Los Angeles delivered his response, the Democratic response in Spanish, which is delightful. Everybody, if you just think about it for a second, think about the big difference between Tijuana and San Diego. Is there a difference in the land, the topography? What's different? Just think about it. There's a line randomly going through the landscape that says, this is Tijuana and this is San Diego. But is there anything different? Any mineral deposits? Anything different? Nope. But yet, very different places. Haven't solved that riddle yet. Haven't figured out what to attribute that to, but very, very different places, those two places.
Particularly once they lose the Chargers. Yeah, there's not going to be much difference at all.
Villaraigosa would like to have the two places be the same. And I don't agree with that. I really don't. All right. Yes. Very heavy. Rachel Perry, how say you?
Yes, Adam.
You ready to do a little news?
I'm ready. Well, hours after Bush's State of the Union address.
Out of the gate, red hot.
It's ironic if you F up the word address. You know what I mean? One time when I was doing Loveline, I yelled at a guy, "You can't even articulate your words." Then I realized that was ironic as well. Articulate shouldn't be such a tough word, because oftentimes you're yelling it at someone who just got done effing up their sentence, and then you screw up articulate.
How do you say that word?
Adult.
See, I always say adult. Oh. And people throw that out at me like there's something wrong with it.
That's fine.
So that's all right?
Yeah.
Okay. So anyway.
Here we go. Starting fresh, baby. Bust that news, Hyman.
Hours after Bush's State of the Union address, where he said that the world should not allow Iran to acquire nuclear or nuclear weapons, the president of Iran addressed supporters, calling the U.S. a hollow superpower and saying that they would continue with their nuclear program. Nuclear.
Yeah. I am good at three things: fighting, screwing, and reading the news.
That's right.
Well, of course, the State of the Union address was last. I'm going to have problems with that all day now. President Bush, of course, said that the union is getting stronger. Well, is strong and getting stronger. Mm. No, I can't even read the news this morning. I'm sorry.
Well, you want to do Dave Sports?
Why don't I just let the president speak for himself?
All right.
This is what he had to say about the war on terror.
The United States will not retreat from the world, and we will never surrender to evil.
I wasn't paying attention. You say always surrender to evil?
No.
Sometimes.
We shouldn't.
We shouldn't not surrender to evil? All right. Let's keep going. I thought I heard him say we should. Okay. Oh, evil. Sorry.
Yeah, evil.
Sorry. Yes, go ahead.
And this is, of course, the president defending his surveillance program.
So to prevent another attack based on authority given to me by the Constitution and by statute, I have authorized a terrorist surveillance program to aggressively pursue the international communications of suspected Al-Qaeda operatives and affiliates to and from America.
Yes. And
who's Terrence?
He's a black guy. It's central.
So he's
evidently
just...
he's where all the trouble's emanating from. Let me say this again to all our ACLU left-wing pussies who are listening. Stop focusing on him listening to a couple of conversations and monitoring a few computers on the internet, and start focusing on them taking almost half of your paycheck every single week. To me, it impacts the average family. You know how you guys would like to help the middle class and help the lower middle class, and these people, they need education and they need college and they need this. One way to help that is them not to have almost half their paycheck taken by the man every single month. Why don't you focus on that? Please Stop focusing on the Ten Commandments out in front of the White House or out front of the courthouse. Stop focusing on the cross that's on the crest of the Los Angeles thing that's on the coffee mug of the mayor. Stop that. Start focusing on them taking half our money, you retards. You would like to give them more. It's retard?
Yes.
My point is the left is all caught up in these guys listening to people's phone calls and all caught up to the Ten Commandments and would like to, in turn, give them more of your paycheck each month. Think about that, everybody. Yeah. They're taking half our money. Anybody? Anyone want to step in at a certain point and bring that to a halt? Or are we just going to focus on their conversations being listened to? Awesome. All right. Sorry.
And, of course,
beautiful Danny from Survivor. $1 million she earned and had almost half of it taken by the man. That breaks my heart.
Earned?
Earned. Earned.
Oh.
$1 million.
One.
$1 million
no,
earned.
One. Oh, so do I win the money that I earn here, or am I earning it, the money that I win here? Don't you win it on Survivor?
Well,
what is that, earning it?
Well, you spend 40 days eating grubs and bathing in sewer water. I would say that's earning it.
We know you don't know who Joe Montana is, but you're aware of the show Survivor, yes, where people win money on it?
He wins money too, doesn't he?
All right, here we go.
Anyway, this is the president talking about one of America's biggest problems and its solution.
America is addicted to oil, which is often imported from unstable parts of the world. The best way to break this addiction is through technology.
Sure.
Oh, he would know about that.
Isn't this like Kate Moss preaching to me about cocaine addiction?
Well, it's a little worse and more ironic.
He?
Yeah, dad's an oil man. Please. We could have solved this. We had a crisis 35 years ago in this country involving oil. If we'd worked on it at the time, we basically, our solution is 30 years later, we have the Cadillac Escalade, everybody. It's 2 feet per gallon.
Barry Bonds, we have to get rid of this steroid problem in baseball.
That's right.
Creep.
Well, of course, the Democrats had their response, and this is the governor of Virginia, Tim Kaine.
My fellow Americans. I'm Tim Kaine, the governor of the Commonwealth of Virginia. It's an honor to give the Democratic response to President Bush.
I'm President Bush. I'm a stupid head. I eat my own poop. Blah, blah, wow. Blah, blah, blah. I like cowboy belts. Blah, 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 blah.
Thank you, and may God continue to bless America.
Wow.
I can't remember.
Dignified.
Yeah, I can't remember his name, so I just call him Crazy Eyebrow.
Yeah.
He had the one eyebrow.
Oh,
like
Adam.
This.
Oh, okay.
Not you.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Tim Kaine.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I know. And how much God talk do we actually need?
Creator.
He was awful.
Our creator.
Yeah, he was horrible. They couldn't do better than that. Villaraigosa would have done it better in Spanish. All right. We got it? Because Bush is on the blower.
Oh, I thought that we had Bush talking to us today. So,
Mike August.
I'd like to hear what he has
nice
to say.
Job.
Yeah, he booked George. I mean, he's a phoner. I wanted him in studio. But it was nice for him to call on the show. George, or Mr. President.
Hey, guys.
How you doing?
Pretty good. Pretty good speech, huh?
Yeah, I thought it was solid.
Huh? Man, it was the one that I wrote. when I wrote started like this, a little bit better. 47 years ago.
Well,
that's all I remember.
Oh, okay. Because I think they already delivered that speech.
Well, I figured I'm working on the same wavelength as network executives. If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Yeah, must have been flattering being carried by 155 networks yesterday.
Yeah, you know, it's all about getting your message out. You know,
mm-hmm.
making people understand where mm-hmm. we're coming from, and that we are addicted to oil. I heard you play that like a mouse is addicted to cheese, man.
Yeah,
or a car is addicted to gasoline, or a dog is addicted to cats. It's the same thing,
right? No, we
Always
are.
This.
Yeah. Well, what about that? I mean, what about ethanol and hydrogen cars and solar power? I don't see enough of that. What are you doing for us in that department,
well,
President?
I have some friends who are working with Legos and.
Uh-huh.
All kinds of stuff, tinker toys and whatnot. These guys are building original models, which mm-hmm. some would, they will.
So you're saying a couple hundred years we might have something?
Well, it might be a little bit longer.
Oh, okay.
But I can't believe that Tim Kaine fella, man.
Yeah.
What's up with that? Hey, when you think about it,
mm-hmm.
The name Kane is in hurricane, which is devastating.
Good point.
Which you failed to mention yesterday.
Think about that when you think about the Democrat response.
Oh, yeah, you don't, it's partisan politics here. How about Iran? When are we going after them?
Well, I think it'll be a while. I think that they, you know, the worst part of war is war.
Wow.
Going to war.
Hold on. Let us digest that for a second.
Think about it.
Wow. It's pretty heavy stuff. You know, people sort of call you a lightweight, like a warmonger, and also a sort of a cranial lightweight. But I don't. That was pretty heavy what you just said there.
I'm the king of America, land of the free, and home of the Whopper, you know? And what it's all about. This is a. This was an important speech, not only to America, but to the universe. You know? And we're working toward a goal of freedom.
Yeah.
And letting freedom ring.
A bell?
A bell, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
That's a good one.
That's awesome. Awesome stuff, Mr. Bush. What's, I didn't hear you bring up Hurricane Katrina or any of the victims last night.
Well, you know, it's difficult to lie, you know.
It's old news.
It's old. Yeah, you know, it's, I mean, the networks aren't concentrating on it. I'm about ratings. And Katrina, it's not a big thing anymore.
I see.
Well, people, at least the your audience seemed to really enjoy it yesterday. I noticed that they applauded for you
a
few times.
Part of them did. I noticed that. The Democrats were not always on my side.
Mm-hmm.
What about what about Hillary?
Yeah.
What about that stuff, man?
Yeah.
That was garbage.
Actually, the Democrats actually applauded themselves for not going with your Social Security plan. They applauded themselves. They gave themselves a standing ovation. They got most of teed you off.
Yeah. Well, it didn't make me happy, fella.
Yeah. Do you think Hillary has a shot? Do you think she has a chance?
At what?
Of being president.
I guess she, what I say the other day, she's formidable.
Yeah, I think it's formidable, Rachel Perry.
Formidable.
Says, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, they say it could be Hillary versus Condoleezza.
Wow.
Now, you're in the Condoleezza camp, yes? She's your number one lady.
Oh, yeah. You know, I think this is, the Condi, as I call her, that's a shortened version of Condoleezza. I think that she is formidable. Is that how I'm supposed to say it there?
Yeah, yeah.
She's formidable. She is. Much more formidable than Hillary, man. What do you think about it?
Yeah, yeah. Little more hair and less ankle. That's how I like my ladies. More hair and less ankle.
There it is, man. Just like Bill.
Thank you for calling in, Mr. President. We're honored to have you on the program.
Sure, guys.
Yeah. Hey, maybe next week you could play a little Ask Us Rodeo with us. I mean...
Maybe, yeah. Sounds good, man.
All right, now get back to running the country. Thank you.
One more thing, fellas.
Yeah.
Seacrest out.
Yeah. Yes. All right, now the great President Bush phoning in. Big Tad has the State of Our Show address. This is a little something he's been working on. How does this set this up for us, Big Tad?
Don't ask me. I just start playing... The music, man.
Wow, he's ready to go.
Well, you just told me to start reading.
No, I didn't say you start reading.
Chomping at the bit.
Let me set it up.
Let's take a break. Please. All right. That's awesome.
Sorry.
That's all right, buddy. We'll take ourselves a break. I'm going to take a shower. And I'm going to take one of those rape showers, too, where I'm like, I can't get clean. You know, music playing. I'm in a fetal position. Just scrubbing. No loofah big enough. And then we'll be back if Big Tad doesn't get fired in the interim for his State of the Show address after this.
This is Kevin Nealon. Give Adam a call at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Yes. And Big Tad can now add something else to his resume, his lard resume. He can add stupid.
Thank you.
Thanks, Big Tad. Tad was going to deliver the State of the Show address. I cued him for that before we went to break, but he got a little confused. He froze up. And
I was nervous because I'm talking to you.
Tad, you've been on the air off and on for, 10 years now?
Yeah.
We've spoken for many, many hours. Remember that van ride to Las Vegas?
Yes, sir.
Where your brother gassed up the entire minivan?
Oh, yeah.
I got to tell you, it was truly the worst 5 hours of my life that then spilled in and became the worst day of my life. Big Tad and his brother in Kimmel to Vegas. And it was Tad's 21st birthday.
Yep.
And Jimmy announced that we're going to rent a van. And by the way, I've had a laugh with Jimmy about this because at the time, this is 10 years ago. Jimmy is doing sports over at K-Rock. I'm living in an apartment with two roommates and swinging a hammer and doing a little Mr. Burcham. And we decide to rent a van and go to Vegas with Big Tad and his brother for Big Tad's 21st. I'll say to Kimmel every once in a while, how much now to pile into a Windstar with Big Tad and his brother and head to Vegas for the weekend? 200 grand?
Who's Tad?
250 grand? Who's Tad? And literally, I would want $200,000 to do that weekend again easily.
What does Tad's brother look like?
I'll tell you, Tad is an onion that you just keep peeling and it keeps smelling worse as you get to the core. I don't even know where to begin. The first part is Big Tad, Jimmy announces he is going to gas up the van all the way to Vegas. He makes this proclamation. Look out. He called there. He's like the Muhammad Ali of farting. He is the mouth from the south.
He's the greatest.
Never stops talking about himself. Big Tad's brother lets his ass do the talking. He's a man of few words. He's the old George Foreman. He'll just stare you down and then put a whooping on you when you get into the ring. So Jimmy's like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to eat a can of raw clams. He actually eats. He actually risks death and botulism just to gas out everyone in this 5-hour van drive. But he is going to eat a raw can of clams. And then, you know, he has a whole ritual. He eats the can of clams. Then he eats some pasta fazool and he drinks like a Diet Pepsi and he eats some pinto beans and all this like 6 hours before we get into the van. So we climb into the van. We've never met Big Tad's brother, who's does not look like Big Tad at all, but has the same brain as Big Tad. And I don't mean in an intellectual par with you. I mean, they actually share one brain. They actually share a brain. And they share half a brain is basically how it works. And the guy, you know, first off, here's the comedy. He's a male stripper.
No.
Yes.
He was.
Yes, and not for chicks with super low self-esteem. He looks good in his underpants. He was a male stripper at the time, which is comical because you got Big Tad over on one side of the van, and then you have the guy with the shaved ass and the thong back on the other side of the van.
What's his name?
Well,
Tim.
Tim.
Is he like Big Tim?
Well, he went by T-Chance Thrasher at the time. Which,
no, he legally changed his name, yes?
He legally changed his name.
Yeah, bring that up, thanks.
All right, the point is
his name.
Jimmy and I had fun with that all the way to Baker. That topic didn't get tired for the first 4 hours of the van ride. But here's the thing. Jimmy came into the van. Yes. Jimmy came into the van. I know we're supposed to talk about other stuff this break, but forget this. Wipe the slate clean. Throw out the Rich Eisen or the guys from Drawn Together. Throw everyone out. I'm doing the next 3 hours on this van ride. It will take longer than the actual ride to Vegas. We will go mile by mile. Jimmy came into the van and Jimmy said, look out, everybody. I am loaded for bear. This is going to be the worst 5 hours of your life because I am going to destroy everyone. We'll not get our cleaning deposit back on this van. I'll guarantee you that. He got about halfway into his proclamation when Big Tad's brother let something fly that devastated everyone in the van. And Jimmy and I, again, it was like the champ going out there had been talking the whole time, and all of a sudden he just got hit with a haymaker and dropped into the canvas. Stunned, shocked. Jimmy and I are like, oh my God, what is that? What's going on?
And my brother was in the back, by the way, all the way in the back, and he's just laying out sleeping. And I could look in the back, as soon as he does it, I look in the back and I see his face and he's just smiling. So I slowly cover my face and I just let it hit Jimmy and Adam.
I was just like, oh my God, Jimmy, no. And then I said, well, he couldn't possibly keep this up. There's no man alive. A regiment could not keep up this kind of funk. But I mean, he'll be gassed out before we get onto the 101. No such luck. This man farted every 35 feet.
all the way to Vegas and never stopped once we got into the room. Nonstop. Tad, please explain this to me. Please, does he have an enzyme problem?
No. It's
yes.
Okay, he does. But it's due to the fact that he's a bodybuilder, so he eats a lot of good food.
No. There's something going on with the flora and the fauna inside of his viscera. He did not stop. He didn't stop. And poor Jimmy and I immediately abandoned trying to fight back with our own ass and got onto the defense. We got into fetal position. Jimmy went through 70 books of matches just lying. And his guy let wind fly. He beefed every mile marker all the way to Vegas. And now we're in Vegas. I got to tell you, Jimmy, who up until this point looked at himself as this sort of reigning king of methane, was if anyone remember, it's what Larry Holmes did to Randall Tex Cobb in the heavyweight division in the late 70s. It's why Howard Cosell gave up boxing commentating. It was a bloody, lopsided shellacking that Mr. Kimmel got.
Bludgeoning.
I've never seen anything like it. A one-man ass army, Big Tad's brother. And then we got to the hotel. And the town was booked up, so we had to stay at the Coronet. Was it the Coronet? Off the strip, and it's where Jimmy... You know, it was a nice hotel because it's where Jimmy lost his virginity in the parking lot of that hotel when he was like 18. We stayed in one room, and I don't mean a suite. I just mean one crappy room. Cookie Jar and the Crumbs were playing in the lobby, and it's a Vegas hotel. It's two stories. That's how bad the Coronet is. We were staying, and they remodeled it recently. It's still a dump, but this was an Uber dump. We stayed in the same room. We had two single beds in a small room. Now, Big Tad, imagine what Big Tad sounds like when he's asleep. You think he sounds bad when he's awake? Imagine the sound that comes out of Big Tad. Yes. Yes, morbidly obese, stricken with narcolepsy, and I just heard his soft palate just flapping in the wind for 5 hours. Mr. Kimmel, the world's loudest non-snorer, according to him. Every time we bunk up, I go, Jimmy, I know you snore, and he goes, oh, no, I don't. And I go, okay, that's what I do. I make it up. That's what I do. I tell people that don't snore, they snore very loudly, because that's the kind of guy I am. Yes, you snore. And Big Tad's brother snores and was still not out of ass. So, I'm lying in this room just staring at the ceiling because it's tough enough for me to fall asleep. Kimmel is blowing gas, sawing logs. Big Tad, I actually threw a shoe at some point because he would not stop, and the brother still continues to blow gas and laugh like a hyena. Worst night, worst day, worst weekend of my life.
Oh, come on.
Am I exaggerating one Smurf's ass hair when I'm talking about your brother's gas on the way to Vegas?
To the T.
I can't believe you grew up.
To the T, Chance Thrasher.
I can't believe you grew up in the same house as that man.
Oh, yeah, we should get him in here and try and see if we can all, how long we can last for
funny.
A show.
Wait till he gets
you
in here.
No, you don't want to.
He has a problem. I'm surprised he's still alive.
Yeah, he got parasites.
I really am. I would have thought his wife would have stabbed him in his sleep, or he would have had some sort of blockage in his lower bowel. Oh, my God. All right. Well, we were going to do a lot of things, but instead it just turned into that. I'm still reeling. You know what? I have post-traumatic stress disorder because of your brother.
I'm sorry.
I wake up sweating 3 times a week yelling, stop the van. All right. We will take ourselves a break. We got our good friends from Drawn Together. For my money, funniest animated show on television. It's not just because I'm on it. We'll talk to them. Oh, man. We got lots of stuff going on. We'll get to it all after this.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call him now. Now at 866-901-ADM.
Yeah. Everyone, settle in. Matt Silverstein and Dave Jesser in studio.
Thank you. This is the collective
creative genius behind Drawn Together on Comedy Central Wednesday nights at 10:30. It's a privilege for me to be a part of this endeavor.
Wow.
It really is.
Well, thanks for being on the show. They only picked up the show once they heard you were on it, apparently.
Well, so it's a little uncomfortable because we're undergoing contract negotiations and I want more money.
and I want more than everybody. And it's one of these things. I deserve it. Yeah. Well, here's what happens. Let me
you
explain.
You do that now voice. That voice of Spanky Ham. It's not the Bertram voice. It's not the Carolla voice.
No, it's not the Bertram voice. It's not the Carolla voice. That's why I don't get stopped in the street, because people don't recognize. Spanky Ham is huge. Nobody thinks it's me.
I'm amazed you know
his
name.
They think it's Tony Randall.
Have you seen the show?
I wrote down Spanky Ham. Okay,
good.
Look, here's the thing. I don't monitor myself. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You've seen yourself on Family Guy. I keep hearing about the Family Guy.
Yeah,
every
you're
time
right.
I listen to this radio show, it's Family Guy. I mean, you're on every episode of our show. You're on like three Family Guy. And I love Family Guy.
You're right.
But they don't need your help.
No, you're right.
We need your
help. Right. You're right. And it's a great show. And you want to know what the problem is? Here's how I am. You know when you played, well, Matt, you're sort of gay, so you didn't play Little League. But Dave, remember when you played Little League? Oh, you're Jewish. Wait a minute. Dave. Oh, Christ. Mike.
Yes.
Brusca. Remember when you played Little League?
Yes, yeah, I do. Yeah.
And the coach, there'd be the coach whose son was on the team.
Oh, he always played.
And he was a good player, but he was tough. He was harder on his own son because he was overcompensating. He never wanted people to say, oh, look at him. He's just, his son has half the talent of my son. He's batting fourth and playing first base. They never wanted it, but he overcompensated. He went too far. That's what I do with Drawn Together.
But isn't that what your parents did to you and you didn't learn any better? Let your parents not watch.
But
any
you know what? You swear
on?
Not to repeat the mistakes of the past, but yet. We're only made of flesh and blood. And cartilage and bone. It keeps going, but you know what I mean. Point is I feel weird because I'm on Drawn Together. I feel like, yeah, I feel self-conscious about it. Don't talk. So the point is I never bring it up, and then it's stupid. I should.
That's it. Yeah, it's a cool show. I didn't realize you were on it.
Thank you. It is.
Is that true?
Yes, I play Spanky Montana, which is the pig. He's a quarterback. He actually throws pig skins, and he's made a pig. It's fun. Write that down, Phil.
Yeah,
that's
we'll
good
use
stuff.
That. You're great.
Yes, the show.
Really.
Here's the thing. The show is funny as hell. I've not seen it, but when I go do looping every once in a while, I see that little part of the show before I have to drop my voice in, and it's always funny.
I think we have a clip, right?
Do we have a clip?
I brought a clip, I thought.
Yeah. Everyone was taking our F in Entertainment Weekly way too hard, but I knew just how to cheer them up. Well, you know what I think of the review? Pull my finger!
Oops. You saw this on the air, Adam.
Oh!
I love this, yeah.
I wish we had a clip of you, though.
I rarely talk about farting, so it's a nice departure every once in a while to get away from the politics and the talks about the arts and the symphony and talk, go scat for just one moment. Matt and Dave, we met. I really feel like we recruited you over at the Man Show. We saw raw talent.
It was an amazing thing. I made these short videos.
Yes.
Somehow you and Daniel got in touch. Half of them had Dave dancing around naked in them.
Yeah, they sent us, I think in the first season of the Man Show, they sent us a video called Indian in the Cupboard. Remember that kids movie? It a Disney movie?
Yeah.
It was actually Indian coming out of the cupboard.
of the cupboard, right. But the movie was, 7-8 years old now, maybe more?
Oh, yeah. It was old when we actually parodied it.
Right. They actually used footage of the movie, except for the miniature Indian was actually Dave Jeser in a leather thong and chaps as a gay Indian shaking his bare ass
at the
camera. And it was hysterical. We could never use it, I think, because of clearance reasons, but we knew genius when we saw it.
Well, thank you.
So Matt, who still doesn't know who Joe Montana is, got on the Man Show.
I'd always be calling Dave on a cell phone, like, "Who's this guy? What kind of sports game is this?" And
let me tell you how spastic. We'll bring her in a moment. Let me tell you, bring her in after the break, Brusca.
I had a hard time fitting in at the Man Show.
Let me tell you how spastic Dave is, or I should say, Matt Silverstein is.
Thank you.
First time I got in his car at the Man Show, he was driving a Cherokee. He was driving a Jeep Cherokee. And I was like, this is a nice car. And he said, my in-laws sent it out from back east. They gave it to us. They shipped it out to us when we got married. Oh, awesome. But the steering wheel was in a position like a tugboat steering wheel is. You know, the steering wheel was aligned with the dash. It was actually not
facing, you know, you weren't driving it like that. Your hands were, it was like you're driving a steamroller. That's basically what it was. And I looked at Dave and I said, Matt, I looked at Matt and I said, Matt, how long have you been driving the car? Since I got it, it's been a year. You know, it's adjustable column. You can move the steering wheel down. Oh, I did not know that. So I just reached over and changed your life. Up until then, he was driving
great.
A steamroller.
My back feels better.
Adam just said he reached over and changed your life. I just wanted to point that out.
Oh, yeah. That happened, too. We did that edible fun thing. That was our first.
Yes.
That was our bonding experience. It was a sketch for the man show.
Where
Adam found out that, you know what? I'm an actor. Remember that?
Yes.
You were like, I'm an actor. You didn't know that before.
The premise pushed you.
The premise of the bit was, every guy has an edible complex. Adam has one. He should go out with his mom and see if he can...
I saw that!
Why fight it?
That was
Jimmy
funny.
Was appalled. Jimmy was like, you wanted nothing to do
that
with
was,
the bit.
It was horrific and hilarious.
Yes,
and
thank
woman,
you.
And he started, and he made out with the older woman.
It was awesome.
So uncomfortable.
Yeah. I remember that.
Jumpyourshark.com. Jumpyourshark.com. That's where they listed the man show as officially jumping the shark.
Really? We did that in season one.
I know. Yeah, when Adam made out with his mom.
Jimmy,
it was great.
Jimmy is a good Catholic, and although he has a bizarre and twisted sense of humor, he would not do that bit, and me and Daniel, our other partner, thought it was funny, so I said, yeah, sure, I'll do that thing with my mom. And there's a couple good lines when I'm dating my mom and eventually trying to get into her pants. There's this one good line at the beginning where I go, I know my mom likes me, but does she like me?
That was great.
Which is nice and twisted. And then later on, I'm shirtless, she's in her bra, she's a 6-year-old woman, and we're in bed. And we're making out. And, of course, Dave, I should say Matt, who I keep calling Dave. Well, here's the problem. I have you guys are on the card in the wrong order. I'm just going to throw
met,
it down.
So.
I know. It's ridiculous. Matt is screaming more tongue. More tongue. Do it again. More tongue. Now, really get into it. And could you cop a feel? And could you...
I really took one for the team. I can't believe that you convinced your mom to do that.
It was not my mom. It was an actress.
Oh.
But she was
so bad of an actress, you thought it was his mom. I mean, that was so great about it.
My mom was funny, too, where my mom actually called up at the man show office while we were writing the script or working out or whatever, and I was laughing. I said, oh, it's my mom's on the phone, everybody. And she's like, oh, hi, dear. And I said, funny you call, Mom. We're just working on a bit that involves you. Oh, I hope it's pleasant. I said, look at it as an homage. And she went, oh, okay, and she hung up. And then she called back like an hour later, and she goes, I looked up the word homage, and I'm tickled pink. I am so flattered. She had to look up the word homage. But
now,
did she ever watch the piece? It's unclear. The Carollas have not gotten cable yet.
I remember when in that piece you yelled at the dad or the actor that played your dad, and you really yelled at him. I don't think
get back in the house, old man.
That was some real anger you had towards the old man. Yeah. I didn't realize.
That's I gotta tell you,
I loved you.
I took that character home and I looked in the mirror. I didn't like what I saw.
Oh.
It was tough taking those man show characters home, having to go home and try to F my own mom. All right, let's take ourselves a little break. We have Dave Jeser and Matt Silverstein, the creative minds behind Drawn Together, 10:30, Wednesday nights, Comedy Central. Best animated show on television,
nice,
for my money.
Nice.
Will, I'm proud to play Spanky Ham and Cree, who's does the voice of Foxy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great voice. She's going to be in here. She's going to read from the Star Jones book.
Oh, great.
Much more to talk about with these guys after this.
You've been listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
866-901-ADAM. Cree Summer, the voice of Foxy Love, has joined us in the studio. Drawn Together, 10:30 Wednesday nights on Comedy Central. Best animated show, nay, best show.
Oh, look
best
at that.
Show.
You're feeling guilty
of any kind.
Wow. You're finally
live
feeling
action,
guilty.
Animated,
about it.
Puppamated, claymated, all better. Better than anything that currently exists
God
on
bless.
Television. I want to say this about Foxy Love.
Yes.
Hot. I got to
wow.
say, and
you.
You feel pathetic being aroused sexually by a cartoon, but
Oh. Yeah, but this, I mean, you're just human.
If you like like the dark chocolate like
chocolate
I do.
Covered, and, freaking habit forming.
And you're a boob man like I am. that cartoon is just made for you. It really is.
And if you stare at Cree, she'll stare back as long as you do it. Anytime we work with her, she does that
look. I like
look.
That.
Yeah, look, it works.
I do look at you, Dave. I find myself when you, because you always have me doing this masturbation. I can say that, right?
Yeah.
You always have me doing those, you know, extreme.
I always have you do these masturbation things.
Well, extreme things like that. And I do find myself locking eyes with you. It's not on purpose. And it's just the vortex.
It's totally accidental.
And then I'm jealous because you don't look at me.
I'll give it to you a little
bit. No, it's fine. I just don't know why don't. Yeah. It's awkward for me because you guys have your moment.
You're right.
Matt Silverstein and Dave Jeser are also in studio. They're the creators of Drawn Together. We met them at the Man Show many years ago, and then they went on to Crank Yankers fame. And
where they were my bosses, by the way.
Over Crank Yankers.
Yeah, they did a great job at Crank Yankers.
No. They you know, bad cop and worst cop. They really gave it to me, but good.
Yeah. Taskmasters. Yeah. Forged by fire.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, no. Look, yeah. Steel man from the Steel
And look
City.
At you now, Dave. We're very proud of you.
Right? If we didn't treat you that way, you wouldn't be where you are.
That's true. Yeah. I appreciate what you did for me, but what I'm excited about is that this Cree summer, of course, I didn't realize until she walked in.
Yes.
Freddy from Different World.
Yes,
no.
Of course.
Yes.
Yes.
And Penny from Inspector Gadget,
that's right.
The first girl
and
I ever
also
masturbated
was,
to.
Also
that's disturbing.
Was in the Return of Billy Jack, so I'm excited as well.
I can't believe you know that. I have a big string of bad B movies.
What was your role in that?
I was the white prostitute's best friend, the black prostitute, and I got shot full of heroin and thrown off a 20-story building.
Wow! Then Tom Laughlin enters the room.
Yeah, and then he sees my dead body and goes, "No!" And then Billy Jack returns.
Wow!
Original.
I've never met the man, but I imagine him to be an exquisite blowhard.
Oh, yes, he is. And he's got all the karate skills of Sammo Hung.
Anytime you got a white guy who clings to the Indian thing, you always got a blowhard. I'm 124th Comanche. That's what gives me my tenacity. Really? Just the 24th part? It's always picture any white guy that ever works the American Indian angle. Huge belt buckle, big turquoisey thing. Start talking about his heritage. Trying to sort of kiss himself into a tribe. He's not a part of. Always a tremendous blowhard. Yes. I want the Indians who pretend to be pale faces. That's the guy I'd like to hang around with. His name is Running Buffalo, but he's changed his name to Chip. And he wants to rush your frat. All right. Also, Matt, I forgot. It's all coming back to me now over at the Man Show. Matt was... Matt is a very troubled person in a sort of friendly package, but Matt wrote something anti-Semitic on the bathroom wall.
No, wait.
At least, just hear my version of it, and then we'll shut your mic and you can plead your case. There was trouble, and here's the whole thing about the Man Show. The Man Show obviously is what you thought it was and more behind the scenes, you know, Cousin Sal, Brian. People's heads all the time. Matt and Cousin Sal dancing to the Mr. Roboto song by Styx, and it was no work going on, and just plenty of, you know, people desecrating each other's desks and workplaces, and there would never be a lawsuit or anything. But it got a little serious. The only time it got serious at the Man Show is when somebody wrote like "Die Jew" above the urinal. What was written there?
It said.
Even more cleverly.
Yeah, what was it? Was it die, you Jew, homo, die, or something?
Above the urinal.
This is the first week, too. No one even knows each other.
That's why I did. Right. Listen, there was stuff on the bathroom wall written about everybody. I'm the new guy. I didn't fit in. I'm not. It's true. So I took out this marker, and it was a huge marker. I'm like, I'm going to write something about myself and be clever. And like, die, Jew, homo, die. That wasn't clever. That's all I had.
So he wrote it on there, and everybody, you know, the first off, there was urine everywhere but the urinal, and there was snot rockets abound, and the place was a mess, and everyone wrote crap all over the place. But somehow the die Jew homo thing, it's, I don't know if you reported it.
No,
who reported
it? No, the first thing, I got rid of the marker. I threw it longer than that. I was like, hopefully, you know, it'll just go away. And
so then you were worried about how unclever it was.
Yeah, that was my biggest thing. I was like, wow, that's not even funny. And they hired me to write funny things.
Yeah.
Drew Homo dies the best I can do. So I'm sitting at my desk, kind of like, all right, you know, maybe now I'll be part of the gang. And then there's the emergency meeting.
Somebody spotted it and called us all in the room. Now, most of the people still thought it was funny, don't get me wrong, but there was one person, I don't know who thought the line was crossed and said,
I think
look,
Daniel got upset.
Daniel, the executive producer, he's a left-wing sympathizer. He came in, honorary Joe. He came in and said, look, you know, we do a lot of screwing around, but this has crossed the line. I want to know who wrote this on the wall.
And I'm like, oh, guys, I think it's so funny. It's so, guys,
Dave,
it's fine.
Please, stay out of this. I'll handle this. You're it's in shock bad, right? Yeah, you're okay. In shock right now. Let me handle it. Now, who wrote this on the wall? Please, stand up. You'll be disciplined. Nobody. And now everyone thinking, all right, someone's in trouble. Somebody crossed the line, and nobody wants to talk. Now, immediately, all eyes turn to Cousin Sal, Jimmy's Cousin Sal, because he's the only one who would do this nonsense. But there were still some other usual suspects in the room, too, and we couldn't figure it out. Come on, please. At a certain point, look, somebody wrote that. Now, we want to know who. Nobody would say a thing. So we started doing handwriting analysis.
Everybody on the staff had to write, die, Jew, homo, die. Which is really, even, and then, you know, Jimmy said, you know what, I bet Matt did it. Matt, you have to do it. Which is retarded, because I did like the most, I mean, it's nothing like my handwriting when I wrote it. Right. So then we all had to go into the bathroom and check the handwriting
on
the wall to the samples.
Oh.
I remember Matt calling me, because I hadn't worked at the man show yet, freaking out, thinking he was going to get fired.
Oh my God, it was terrifying.
He totally screwed up.
So
Daniel hated
checking
him.
all the handwriting with the writing on the wall.
Right.
And unbelievably, it matched Sal's handwriting perfectly. And the guy you're most likely to... And Sal freaked out.
Yeah, I know, because...
You framed a guilty man.
Yeah. Listen, Sal, listen. No, and I accepted his apology. And I said, you know, I understand you were trying to be funny. It's not that funny, but you tried. And
it was really bizarre because only, you know, we'd immediately taken Matt off the list of suspects and no one else would cop to it, obviously, because no one knew anything about it. And it was just, we just kept chasing our tail for weeks. I couldn't imagine that it was you.
That's the sweetest, most diabolical part about it. When did you finally cop to it that it was you?
Like 2 years later.
That's the beauty.
Wasn't later that week.
Holding on to that one.
Sal, the entire time, kept like for years, came up to me and said, listen, man, it wasn't me, and I feel horrible. I would never say that about you. I'm like, Sal, dude, it's okay. I forgive you. It's no big deal. And then 2 years later, I said, hey, I just one day at lunch, I'm like, oh, hey, Sal, by the way, I wrote that.
Yeah.
Sal, to make up for it, is giving him 8 Hanukkah gifts every year.
Yeah.
I think while Matt's admitting things, I think this is a good time to admit something else. You probably get it off your chest.
By the way, I don't know if your people believe in a hell, but my people know there's one. And when you're there, say hi to Morton Downey Jr., who did the same thing in an airport bathroom.
The only thing I have to admit is that Drawn Together is now available on iTunes. iTunes, and you can download it. And tonight's episode hasn't even aired yet. You can get it on iTunes.
Really?
First ever premiere on iTunes.
And it's a fantastic episode. So that's the right thing.
Wednesday night, 10:30, by the way, on Comedy Central. A fantastic show. I don't take my word for it, Patrick.
How's it going?
You love Drawn Together?
Yeah, man. I'm just calling to say, I mean, like, everyone screams about Family Guy, like, it cures cancer.
Mm-hmm. But Drawn Together cures cancer.
It does.
That's the truth.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, this is the next South Park, for sure.
Yeah.
Very excited about it.
Your energy level.
It is an awesome show. Yeah, try to contain yourself, Patrick. We know you're nervous, and we know you're a huge fan, but try to reel it in just a little bit.
Did you know you're talking to the real Foxy Love here? Is that exciting, Patrick, or is this...
Say hi, Patrick.
What's up, Papa?
Yeah, I just...
don't break a sweat, Patrick.
The episode with Captain Hero was just on... The one where he's paralyzed.
That's a good one.
Very tasteful episode.
Hi, Patrick.
Well, thanks for watching, Patrick.
Thank you, Patrick.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thanks.
Get back to reaming your bong. Do people do that anymore with the coat hangers?
We have the most stoned audience in the world.
I love it.
Just too high to turn off the show, the network after South Park and before The Daily Show.
I feel, again, and by the way, Matt, do you have something to say? Is there something that Dave wanted you to say? There's something horrible
admit
that you need to say?
What is this?
You guys know about it. It's not like was the whole note thing on the car. I wanted to talk about it.
I finally wanted to come clean with something. This is a good time.
What do you know about that?
Oh, the note on the car?
Yeah, it was very confusing. It was messy. Best just move on.
was that Man Show or Drawn Together?
I had left.
I'm sorry.
Crank Yankers. It was Man Show, but I had left the Man Show.
Right.
And then that's when it happened.
What happened with the note on the car? I remember that one, but I don't remember all the details from it.
Put it on our head writers.
It's just weird. So I left the Man Show, and I didn't feel like I was part of the gang.
Right.
And there was a writer that you decided you'd left.
You'd left to desecrate synagogues, or what were you up to?
No, I went to do right on Greg the Bunny. Is what we're working on.
All right.
And while it was fun to work, it's nothing compares to working on the Man Show.
There are no juggies, there are no porn.
Yeah, there's no midgets.
Right.
So this writer got a job. I guess he kind of got my slot.
I was jealous.
Even though you quit.
You quit the show and someone took your job.
And I got jealous. And this is a guy that I was kind of his PA.
Right.
On an earlier
show. Chuck, our head writer.
Right. I don't know why I thought I was deserving of the head writer position.
Right.
But I thought that was my job and Chuck took it. This is terrible. He doesn't know that. All right. So, for some reason, I'm feeling out of it. I'm upset. I'm jealous.
I'm insane.
The voice is in my head. It won't shut up. I'm driving home. Something hits me. I'm like, hey, it'd be really funny if I just write down on a note, hey, sorry I hit your car. Didn't mean to. Give me a call. We'll take care of it. Love, Chuck. And then I gave the Man Show phone number.
Uh-huh.
And I put that on one car. And then I got back in my car. I was like, ah, that's pretty funny. I'll do it to another car. And then I started being like, hey, jerk, learn how to park, you idiot. Just call me. I'll take care of it, Chuck, the Man Show.
And then we had gotten out to like four or five people.
So then I called Dave. I'm like, hey, Dave, in your neighborhood, will you go out and do this?
I had my roommate doing it. We had like 10 cars.
So now like 100 cars have these notes on it that, hey, sorry. And any schmuck who looks at their car sees a little ding, we'll be like, oh, good, I can get this schmuck to pay for it.
Right.
I think it's probably
illegal. I guess that morning, the phone of the Man Show just rang off the hook with people like, I want to talk to Chuck, he hit my car.
Yeah.
He had a lawyer, whatever. So somehow Jimmy again.
Yeah.
Just sort
he
of
sussed it out.
Yeah, so he calls me over at my new job.
I'll tell you why Jimmy susses these things out, because it's like any good movie where they go, in order to catch a criminal, you have to be a criminal. Like, Jimmy is so twisted and diabolical and loves effing with people so much that he immediately understands that in any situation, and he can isolate that and focus on it.
Which is good. Any normal detective show, you would think that you would follow the motivation, and they would never get back to
no motivation.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no way to trail back to who would benefit the most from this.
And poor Chuck, who's a more neurotic Jew than Matt, and it's going to, you know, therapist three times a week, is already pulling his own hair out and can't stand everyone over at the Man Show. It's really now plummeted to new depths.
So then Jimmy calls me, and I'm like, Jimmy, swear to God, wasn't me. I've denied it. And then, of course, Jimmy then calls Sal, and everybody now again thinks it's Sal, and so like, I didn't do it.
I had to come clean because I lied to Jimmy,
and that's the thing I regret the most.
Wow,
yeah. Look at this.
Wow,
very therapeutic. You feel better now. Yeah. You didn't want to admit it, and now
this is terrible.
Wow,
I didn't really want to discuss this again.
Earl,
yeah,
you're a fan of Cree.
No, I'm Cree's boyfriend.
Oh, what? You are?
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh,
my does God. She know you're her boyfriend?
You don't
boyfriend?
Sound like a white guy.
Hello?
You don't sound like a white guy, Dave.
You're Cree's boyfriend?
I want to be Cree's boyfriend.
Uh-oh.
Now, and here's why.
Okay.
I watched Drawn Together, and I'm a little confused.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no.
Because I'm attracted to the Foxy Love character.
Mm. Right, but you wouldn't hang out with a black chick on purpose.
Well, hang on now. Mm-hmm. Let's not go there now.
Okay.
Come on.
Mm-hmm.
I'm confused about her cartoon.
Because
I've been a fan of cartoons ever since I was a little boy.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't never remember seeing no Mr. Solving Musician cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
What was the name of the cartoon?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Does anyone have any idea what Earl?
There's a few mystery-solving cartoons. There's Scooby-Doo's, and there's a Josie.
No, but what's the name of the one that Foxy Love is on?
Oh,
she was in the Foxy Love and the Foxy Five.
Yeah.
It's back in the 70s.
Yeah, it was very, very popular.
All right, Earl. Please.
There were half foxes, half black singer investigators.
Half five.
Started half off five. With such promise. And
yes, it
just
did.
Immediately ground to a halt.
Yeah. Damshake thought that was a Baba Booey call.
I was betting on it.
Really?
Yeah.
I've only had a couple.
Oh, that's
yeah.
it?
Yeah. I'm a little disappointed myself. To me, it's not.
It trailed off after the first week.
It's not. It, to me, it just means there's no one listening. It doesn't mean they like the show and have given up. They just, no one cares. Cree is going to read now.
Oh, yes.
From the Star Jones book, Shine.
Shine, from ashy to shine.
As a Foxy Love from
this,
drawn
this
together.
This particular passage is describing her sexual past with her now husband, Al Reynolds.
Wow.
Before they got married.
This is before, yeah.
Wow.
And this is as Foxy Love?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So we has an intimate, intoxicatingly sexual connection for the first 2 months of our relationship. We traveled to Jamaica together, and I had someone who wanted to be there just for me. With Al, I walked on the beach for the first time in my adult life without getting winded. We walked a mile, and we talked and talked seriously about marriage, just by ourselves and then even with other people. We talked about what it meant, that commitment. And we made the decision that because we knew this was all moving too quickly, we wanted to bring a spiritual advisor into this relationship. Shine, Star Jones.
Wow. I like the way you put a button on it.
Yeah, shine on.
I like that she knew she was in love when it was the first time she'd ever walked with an adult and she didn't get winded.
That is so frightening.
Sign of love.
The first time.
Normally she drags an oxygen tank along the sand. It's so romantic.
And it's true.
Yeah, this is her admission. This isn't someone else saying it.
That's the first time we've had a woman read from that, I think. And it was the closest. I could actually. I heard Star Jones' thoughts in that voice.
Yes, if you took Cree and wrapped her with 700 pounds of bacon, it would have been like actually sitting next to Star Jones while she was reading. Drawn Together, everybody. 10:30 Wednesday nights. Matt, Dave, Cree, God bless you.
Oh, God bless you. Thanks for being on the show.
It's amazing.
Wonderful job.
Thanks for being
nothing personal about the contract dispute. You know, it's just no, I got a pretty big monthly nut. We'll take a quick break, and we'll be... Ooh, David Guest.
Baba Booey.
Liza Minnelli's ex is coming in here.
Just came in.
We're also going to talk to the mayor of Seattle. All that after this.
Hi, this is Stewie Griffin. Call Adam Carolla now at 1-866-901-ADAM.
Yes, 866-901-ADAM. David Guest is in studio. David is a movie producer, I should say, music producer. Would that be your title?
Yeah, that would be right.
And you've done that your whole adult life, pretty much?
Pretty much.
And lived across the street or next door to Michael Jackson growing up in Encino?
A few blocks away.
Close enough.
Close
enough. And hung out with Michael Jackson.
All the brothers.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
When you say brothers, you mean the Jackson brothers, not just exclusively black men.
No, I'd say, and the sisters, too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
And when you, okay. And, of course, notably married to Liza Minnelli for a while, but that's all in the rearview mirror. I enjoyed your appearance on Jimmy Kimmel Live, by the way.
Thank you.
I think it was last week, maybe 2 weeks ago.
Yep.
Was hearing you talk about hanging with Michael, going out. Going to Dupar's, just doing regular stuff.
Yeah, we always did regular stuff as kids. I mean, the perception of Michael Jackson is so different from what the real Michael Jackson is like. He doesn't talk in that, hi, how are you?
He doesn't.
No, it's all an act.
Really?
Yeah.
Is it?
What?
You think?
What? What?
Well, it's like, well, what about, I mean, what about Marilyn Monroe? You know, what about women who sort of put it
phony
on?
Phony McPhonestein.
You know what I mean?
McPhonestein.
I don't think Michael Jackson was Jewish.
Oh.
But yeah.
They're still wondering if he's black.
Yeah. Really? What? Oh, what happened? Yeah. Now, what about that? You've seen him change over the years, obviously. Yeah. I mean, there's all the cosmetic stuff, but the color of the skin, too. Do you buy any of that hype that he has
a
disease?
I really don't know because I don't know much about the disease. I just know him as a different type of person because when he talks, he goes, hey, I'm going to have Quincy do this. I want to spend $100,000 on a billboard. Damn it. And, you know, he cusses and he talks like a normal person. It's not the act that you see. And you're going, whoa. But the truth is, there's a different Michael Jackson from the one that the public sees. And, you know, the thing is, he should really be himself because he'd have a better rep than he has now.
So that high-pitched voice is all, like, he puts that on. He does this, I assume, because he thinks that that's going to protect him. Like, people are going to look at him in a different way, and it's sort of like a front that he puts up so people don't judge him.
Well, he needs for people to look at him in a different way because, you know, what's happened has not been good. But, you know, when you go down, there's no place to go but up. And, you know,
sometimes you just stay there, like when they bury you.
Yeah, but, you know, some from the dead have arisen.
Do you think he's going to rise like a phoenix from the ashes?
Would you go see him if he and the Jackson 5 reunited for a concert?
I would, or yeah, I wouldn't bring the kids, but I would go. Are you going to do that? Are you going to be part of that?
I don't know.
Will he listen to you? Will he take your phone calls?
He'll take my phone calls.
What do you mean, I don't know? Are you planning on trying it?
Yeah, what does that mean?
I mean, you're bringing it up for a reason. Come on.
Hey. I think there's a good chance that there will be a Jackson 5 reunion in the future.
What you should do is if you could get him to talk in the real voice, that would also have some cachet. Who wouldn't be interested in hearing that if you suddenly got him to do the real voice?
I'm not disagreeing with you.
It's like Paris Hilton. I hear that she's all, you know, like, hey, everyone. And then you get her alone. She's like, give me a Subway sandwich.
Yeah. Everyone turns into Satan as soon as everyone leaves the room. So I know you probably don't want to talk too much about Liza. Is there a lawsuit pending? Waiting to settle that? Because I saw the whole, what was it, 2020? 48 hours. I saw a whole special on you guys and you talking about her banging you in the back of the head and all that pain medication, all that.
Yeah, I mean, it's real. I mean, you know, she's a great woman.
Is she?
Oh, just incredible talent.
Yeah. Well, she has a talent.
She was good on Arrested Development.
No, she's great talent. And then she gets drunk.
I like her on Arrested Development.
Really?
Well, we'll just say, you know, listen, alcohol is a bad disease.
Yeah.
And when you try to help somebody, and you know, the true story is, you know, I picked her up over my head and she was drunk. She had drank 2 quarts of vodka.
Mm-hmm.
And I was worried about whether she would jump out a window, do something destructive. And, you know, not realizing when you pick somebody up over your head and they keep hitting the back of your head, not that it hurt when it happened, but eventually it broke all the blood vessels and I lost 2 years of my life. But, you know, this is the past. And I have no ill will for her.
Really? I would have ill and will and then some ill.
Yeah,
and
but
will
that,
again.
That gets you nowhere. You know what? This is the present. I'm working again. I'm back. And, you know, let her go see New York.
How much does she weigh that you can lift this woman over her head? Did you hold her and then suplex her after?
He piled her over.
I'd call it suplex, but, you want to protect somebody that you love and you want to, make sure that they, you know, they're in bed and that they sleep it off. Mm. And anybody who's been with an alcoholic knows that it's not a fun disease to deal with.
I know. And ask my wife. I mean,
ask
me. Yeah. Are you remarried?
No.
We're
not divorced yet. We're not.
Oh, you're
divorced.
Not?
What? No.
Oh,
it's
really?
Still, yeah. We can't get divorced until we settle the battery case.
Really?
Yeah. So
why can't you get divorced and then finish the battery case?
Why don't you
case?
Talk to the judge and call him up right now?
I think I will.
Call him right now.
Fresca, get Ito on the blower. The talking brass tacks. Ito, smart guy, a guy who, like Michael Jackson, has been keeping a little bit of a low profile, you know. Not bad. And what about Michael? Where is he? In Bahrain or something?
Yeah, he's in Bahrain.
He was in Germany a little.
Is he coming back? Think he's just going to relocate?
He's got to come back.
He does?
Yeah.
How do you think he's doing financially? Do you think he has enough?
How do you think he's doing financially?
It's hard to tell because Michael Jackson is sort of like Mike Tyson. And it's like, well, we know they've made hundreds of millions of dollars over their career. On the other hand, we know they owe tons of money. But when you say these guys are broke, is it broke? Like, what? You know, I could tell you what broke is. Broke is just not having any money. These guys are broke, but yet they still live in this house and they still have security guards and they still fly chartered airplanes. So, you know, which is it? It's hard to tell. I couldn't tell you. I know he was sort of a chronic shopper. I saw the documentary. He was just going to, like, the Caesar's gift shop and buying, you know, but statues of alabaster.
That was an all an act.
You think he was just showing off?
I don't think he bought it. That stuff.
Do you think he's set for life? Or I guess he could always start selling off the Beatles, you know, songs or something, right?
I really don't know. I mean, I really haven't followed his financial career.
You consider yourself an expert in music, right? I mean, you've produced.
I've worked with a lot of people. You know, I've worked with Whitney. I've done about 8 shows with her. Just did Dionne Warwick, which was a big, huge success, and Michael, which
beautiful woman, Dionne Warwick, huge nostrils, some of the biggest nostrils. Yeah. I believe that's why she's such a good singer. She can take like a jet intake on her. But
are you talking about the right
woman.
Nostril or the left nostril?
They're both big enough.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so
they're
make sure.
Tremendous nostrils on that woman, but sings like a lark. I was thinking about something. Something reminded me earlier in the show because we had this Elvis song. One of my favorite old Elvis songs. Doesn't get played very much anymore. Let's hear a little shot of it if you've got it. You remember this one, Dave?
Yeah.
A very old friend. Good song.
Yeah.
Guy, it's an interesting song. He's singing about his friend who has found a new love. And as his friend starts bragging about his new love and how much he loves her, he starts realizing, that's my chick. Interesting. Interesting twist. Yeah.
That's sad.
Point is, and I don't know why we do this, why we take Elvis's, you know, 5 or 10 songs that we're all tired of hearing and hear Jailhouse Rock, Oh, Love Me Tender, over and over and over again, but we don't... piano coming in.
Depth, yeah.
Yeah. He smiled, but he was burning inside.
Emotional torment. Yes.
Yeah. There's a good line here. He was gone, but his words kept returning. All right. Point is...
He's angrier than Liza with a couple quarts of booze in
her. Smirnoff in her, yeah.
Is that what
Liza
happened?
Is one of the toughest dudes there is.
15 years later, this song... If you listen to that riff... Now, listen to this song by the Go-Go's that came out. Why does this sound like a crappy version of that song? My little experiment's not going to work because it sounds like the Chipmunks, not the Go-Go's. Oh, maybe it's live. All right, we'll leave it for a second, and we'll get to the part that's the exact same riff. This is why my wife wants a divorce, by the way, because I rant about this stuff. She has no idea.
Conspiracy theories about things nobody cares about.
That's my life. Getting super angry about stuff no one even knows. All right, now listen to this. Was that the song? Yeah. All right.
I'll sing the Elvis lyrics over it.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. But well, take us 3 weeks to figure that one out. Point is I always thought the dun 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 dun. I always thought the riff was the same, but yet there's never a lawsuit. But then you have George Harrison, who gets sued for doing the He's So Fine song, ripping off the Chiffon's song, and they win millions of dollars, sounding like My Sweet Lord, which doesn't sound the same to me. So how does that work, and how can we get in on it? That's what I'm saying. I like that.
First, you got to be a writer.
I want to sue the Go-Go's, and I want to represent the Elvis estate. Can you work that out?
I live in Memphis. What do you want?
Do you?
Yeah.
You're there full time?
Part time of the year. Part time.
Is that because it's the music capital?
No, it's because I've got peace and quiet from the tabloids.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
But why put yourself out there if you know you're only going to get these pot shots about, you know, Liza and all that?
Oh, you know, I'm used to the pot shots. You know, when you're in this business, you got to take it. I mean, you know, you're marrying a 91-year-old woman. I mean, come on. I mean, what would I do with a 91-year-old woman?
Shots.
Wow.
I mean, she can't even, she's in a wheelchair. I mean, so, you know, these things are ridiculous. I'm used to all that. And I've been lucky. I'm writing my autobiography right now, mm-hmm. and it's called The Guest List from A to Z. And it's, it really tells a lot of stories from Jim Morrison.
Oh, you knew Jim Morrison?
Oh, yeah. I was there for the recording of, Touch Me. Remember that song? Come On, Touch Me, Babe.
Oh, sure.
And that was done at TT&G
Studios.
He
hated that song.
And I was there.
He didn't like that one. He thought it was a kiss-ass song.
Well, I was there for that.
Wow.
And Hello, I Love You.
Thank you. I'm quite fond of you as well, David.
Oh, well, thank you so much.
We'll take ourselves a quick break. David Guest is here. We'll finish unraveling his yarn after this.
You're listening to The Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
That's right. 866-901. Adam's phone number. David Guest. Producer, Jackson Neighbor, ex-Manelli. Ex-Manelli feels weird. David Guest in the studio. I was watching him on the Great Jimmy Kimmel Live show last week, and he was talking about going out for late-night flapjacks with Michael Jackson and in the unfortunately named Sambo's restaurant, which used to be on Ventura Boulevard. I remember it well growing up in the valley myself, not the lofty south of the boulevard Encino, but the working class North Hollywood.
And Tarzana.
Yeah. Oh, you grew up in Tarzana as well.
There was one in Tarzana.
Oh, there was. Yeah. There was one in Studio City.
Studio City and Tarzana.
I think the Sambos all became Denny's or something at some point.
You're right.
And it's got to be rough whether you're Sambos and you have 500 chains spread out over the United States or you're AIDS diet chocolate. At some point when your name becomes synonymous with something bad, it's just got to be rough to take the sign down or to do whatever. But you were eating at, and was there any racial overtones to eating at Sambo's when you go in there with a black man? I mean, did was it considered derogatory back then?
I don't think we ever thought about it. We thought about the pancakes.
Oh, you should have hung with me. I would have immediately glommed onto that. Well, if not, I mean, if you think about it, when did it become bad then? I mean, this is, we're talking about the late 70s or
mid 70s.
Mid 70s. If Sambo is not a derogatory term for black in the mid 70s, when does it turn the corner? You know what I mean? I thought we had all that stuff in place from the 40s on. We had, you know, we had the N-word and we had all the, I don't know what else you got, Jigaboo and all this stuff. It's all in place. It's all, so it's 200 years old. When did Sambo get bad?
Yeah.
We got to work this out. Well,
you'll have to think about it.
Somebody get to the bottom of that. Oh, I'm not, but I pay people to think about it for me. Get to the bottom of Sambo's. I'm going 79. Maybe it was in a movie or something. Anyway, you would sit there and eat pancakes late night with the Jackson boys?
Yeah, we'd usually go to the concert at the Roxy, see Stevie Wonder or the Four Tops or Chairman of the Board, Rufus Thomas.
Mm-hmm.
He'd go to a lot of concerts. He loved music and... he loved real, raw R&B, Wilson Pickett. These are the people that inspired Michael. And so he loved to go see them.
And did you ever produce him or work with him creatively? I mean, you get into the music business at some stage.
Yeah. You know what? Thinking back, right when they left Motown, I handled their PR. It must have been about 75 before I got into producing. And, you know, he was the one who said, you know, you got to give this crap up and stop working for people and working for yourself. And he had a love of film. And I wasn't a real film buff, but we knew a lot of people that were friends. Gene Kelly, Ginger Rogers, Betty Davis, Fred Astaire, you know, all the greats. And we'd spend a lot of time with these people and we'd hear these great stories from them. And Michael said, why don't we form an organization that would help all these actors who have no money, who are destitute? And we started the American Cinema Awards Foundation. Basically, what we did was we raised about $6 million for the Motion Picture Home in Woodland Hills, built a whole wing that's still there, named after all these great actors.
I'm hoping someone is working on a morning show jock home that I can retire to one day with the, sitting next to the Booger Man, the Grease Man, and Boomer and the Nudge.
There is one now.
Be awesome. Guys ringing cowbells all hours.
Really? Yeah, in Compton, the Wolfman Jack.
There is.
For retired.
I'm going out
for
there.
Retired disc jockeys.
When you're sitting there over flapjacks with Michael, does he, you know, it's late at night. Are you guys talking? Does he say things like, I had this girl by my place last night. I talk about syrup. I got to save that for when she comes back. You know, does he talk about the ladies?
He was in love with Brooke Shields at that time.
Really?
Yeah, he really
boyish,
was.
Boyish infatuation, yeah. Or is he really
no, he
desires?
Used the, he used
or?
The other words.
Really?
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 Oh,
like,
God,
like
what? Really?
What? Like what?
Well, there's a lady here. I could never say them.
No, I don't. I'm not. Oh,
no,
a lady.
No. I'm sorry. Can't do it.
X-rated like is what you mean, though. You're saying X-rated language.
Oh, yeah. Ooh.
So you think Huffing? At some point he had an appetite for the ladies?
I don't think he was ever into boys.
No.
I really don't believe that.
But
crap.
What about now? You don't believe it now?
I don't believe. You know what? I can't picture him doing something to a little kid. I mean, just to me is... It's wrong, and I just can't see him doing it. People want money from people like Michael Jackson. He's a great target because he's a good kid, and he likes to help people. And when you're nice to people in this business, you get taken advantage of.
So you just... I know, that's why I'm never going to be nice. You think he's
just... Is that a promise?
He's just quirky. I mean, he's just... We are mistaking this for pedophilia, but in actuality, he's really just eccentric. Crazily eccentric. Has the kids over, sleeps with the kids, romps around with the kids, and not attracted
it's
to them.
But he should have adopted. My feeling is he should have adopted kids early on, and you know, had his own kids there because he's been a great father. I mean, I've seen him with his kids, and he really, you know, he makes sure they get a great education.
Well, let me ask. Jump in for 1 second. I've always been perplexed. How is it his kids look like? Macaulay Culkin when Macaulay was 5. How are they blonde and fair? I mean, people need to do the math. When you're black and he was formerly black, he didn't have his jeans bleached. He just, wow, heavy. He didn't have his jeans bleached.
Simple
he had
answer.
His skin
Simple
bleached.
Answer.
How is the kid's
Simple
white?
Simple answer.
What?
He knew Macaulay's mother.
Ooh, and it's not his seed.
No, you're not sure about that.
I am. You know why? Here's what I want to say. Turn that down for a second. Let's hold on a second. Let's just do the math. The black gene is sort of dominant. If you take a fair-skinned person and a dark-skinned person and you put them together, the kid is going to end up looking more black than he is going to look white. That's just the way it goes. It's like putting a drop of black paint in a gallon of white paint. It'll turn it sort of. You know,
right.
Chocolatey. It dominates. It dominates. They have it dominant.
At least they don't have blonde hair at the very least.
They're gonna have the kinky hair. They'll never have the straight hair. Their skin will be darker. I mean, it just dominates. I don't mean that in an insensitive racial way. I'm saying black and white. You end up looking a little more black than white. He has a kid who has fine blonde hair and is lily white. I find that mathematically impossible if it came. From his loins, yes.
How say you?
How say you?
You gotta ask him. I'm, you know.
Get him on, Broska.
Get him on.
Yeah,
by the way, we get him in 2 minutes.
Believe me, we couldn't get Tarantino to phone in to the show. You understand? We're not going to get Michael Jackson's dude. But is my math correct? What do you think of that?
I have no comment.
No comment. The silence is deafening, sir.
Yeah.
Deafening. All right. We're going to take a break. I want to thank David Guest for coming in.
I hope he'll be back.
The guest list is the name of his book. It is coming out when?
Spring of 2007.
Right.
Spring of 2007. I'm going to the Borders and getting in line in advance. We'll look forward to that. Come back at any time. Dish the Dirt. And we'll be right back after this.
My pleasure.
This is James Rice. I'm looking for Adam Carolla. I need him for a spa party because he's been talking a lot of junk about me lately. So you know what? All you out there, listen to Adam Carolla.
Yeah. James Tony. James Lights Out Tony. Probably 75-5. What a badass. A guy fought. He was a champion at 150 pounds, and now he's a champion at 250 pounds. No white guy could ever pull that off. Imagine what you'd look like, Shaq. Imagine. And by the way, you're 180 now, whatever you are. You're fighting at 155. Now we'll go ahead and put you at 235. See what you look like with your shirt off in the ring.
I could do it.
You know what your best punch would be, your best move? You would squeeze one breast, fire some lactation into the eye of your opponent, and then just dry hump him into submission.
Not enough of that going on anymore, defeating your opponent by throwing something in his eyes.
Well, you'd throw sand. The guy would always go down and throw some sand.
Always sand nearby in a fight in the movies.
Yeah, and it was great, because if you got hit with the sand, you had to drop your gun and cling to both eyeballs with your hands. Right. Open hand.
Because the sand has some burning chemical in it.
All right. Hopefully the mayor, Greg Nichols, is going to call in from Seattle in a couple of few. But first, we have Rachel Perry with the news.
Good news. A Japanese toilet seat manufacturer is opening a plant in Mexico to keep up with the growing demand in America for heated toilet seats.
I told you. I was on the vanguard of the heated toilet seats. I was the tip of the spear of that. Many years ago, I've had one. Yes.
I want one.
What's wrong with your ass being all cozy?
Nothing. How say you? I say
yay.
Yay. Jennifer San Marco, the woman that gunned down six people how many people was it?
Six people at work, I think, and then killed herself, I guess, but she killed somebody at an apartment, evidently, beforehand.
Do you want to...
Did I step on your story?
No, of course not, but I was just actually going to give you the update. Apparently, there was one person who had sort of survived, but now died. Yes, the last person died.
From the plant, from the mail sorting facility.
Yeah, and then, of course, they found another person at a condo where she used to live.
Yeah, here's the thing. Everyone is always shocked when they hear this, but if you do the math, think how many guns are in circulation in this country. I mean, I really do think there is as many as there is citizens of this country, possibly more. And then you think about the number of nut jobs that are in this country. Why doesn't this happen every week? I mean, any nut job can get their hand on a Glock or a 9mm. Why doesn't this happen every week? You drive home, you pass 10 gun shops and 100 guys talking to themselves on the street. Why doesn't this happen every week? I'm not disappointed, but I'm sounding a little disappointed by it. But you really do think about it. Doesn't happen as much as it should.
Let's not get the kooks up in arms here, though.
Yes, let's go, kooks. All right. you okay?
Yeah, you know what? I'm kind of coming down with a
cold. What's happening,
Rachel? I'm feeling a little...
Is it that time of the month?
You know what? Coincidentally, it is, and I'm coming down with a cold.
Wow, 1-2 punch. Right in the loins.
Well, the president gave the State of the Union address last night. He said the State of the Union is strong and getting stronger. He addressed the war in Iraq, the economy, healthcare, education, his surveillance program, and, of course, Social Security. I guess he said when he brought up, that Congress didn't pass his Social Security bill, Hillary Clinton led a rousing standing ovation for the Democrats. Which was kind of bizarre.
Hypothetical. One more time, I posed it a few weeks ago. Bill and Hillary married. Bill sells used cars for a living, and Hillary is a legal secretary. How long does the marriage last?
Well, they're both already on to their third marriages, fourth marriages.
Yeah, Bill would be on to his fourth marriage.
At least
by
he
now.
Would be, right.
Yes, and she'd be trying to get her marriage legalized. And probably just the state of Hawaii would only recognize her union with another woman. Yes. Yes. If anyone, please do the math. How fast would those two be away from each other? Well, that's how you know they're both liars. That's all.
The president said that America has a problem and he knows the solution.
America is addicted to oil, which is often imported from unstable parts of the world. The best way to break this addiction is through technology.
I'm starting to think that he, because he's all into the oil thing. I bet he's in on the ground floor of this new technology. He's now going to
Well, that's when the man can figure out a way to make money from it. That's when it's going to come in. I mean, all right, I'm getting on my soapbox and getting a little preachy here for a second, Dave.
Please.
Start cutting that sports down now, because it's going to take a minute. But you think about it, everyone. You ever watch these shows on the Discovery Channel or the History Channel, and some oil conglomerate is going to take some derrick that they drop out in the North Sea, and it costs $200 billion to construct, and they're going to go drop it out in the middle of the ocean. They're going to drag it out by barge. They're going to sink it. Think how much money they have wrapped up in petroleum. Think how long it takes for that $200 or $500 billion oil derrick that's sitting out in the middle of the North Atlantic to pay for itself. Now, if that's what you have, and you need that thing to keep producing for 30 years, and somebody says, hey, I got an idea for a solar-powered car. Well, what do? You hire some guys with white teeth and nice suits to head on down to Washington and make sure it doesn't go that way. Because we have a ton of money, and we can't afford to lose it. And by the way, we've put all our chips in this on this number, and we got to ride it out. And the day they start coming up with all this alternative stuff is the day these guys are out of business. Now, if they come up with the alternative stuff, then it's fine. We can use it. Someone has to give them the incentive to do that.
Yep. Start a war, drive gas prices up, then make money, get in on the ground floor of the new energy.
How dare he tell the nation that we're addicted to oil? This is the equivalent of Tad sitting me down and lecturing me about the fact that donuts are going to make me fat.
Yes.
You see?
Yes.
Pshaw.
Yeah.
Harumph.
Yes.
And of course, the Democrats had a response to the State of the Union. This is my man, Tim Crazy Eyebrow Kane, governor of Virginia.
Mm-hmm. There's a better way. The administration is falling behind in other critical areas, but we managed to find a better way. The better way is to focus on service. And for the day when service returns again as the better way to a new national politics.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what he was trying to say, but
I don't know either. I do know Robert Palmer has a new song from the grave, by the way. Yes, he's still doing work. He's entombed, but he brought a Casio.
I hope it's better than it was when he was living.
And by the way, if I die, don't bury me with any work-related items. You know, I don't want to be one of these composers that gets buried with his wand. I don't want to work when I'm dead. That's what I'm saying. Don't give me a shovel, a hammer, and an abacus or anything. Leave it out. I need some porn and some lotion and a flashlight in case I wake up. All right. Let's hear Robert Palmer's new song.
Addicted to oil.
Powerful.
Addicted to oil. Addicted to oil. Keeping America competitive requires affordable energy.
I miss those guitar girls.
Zero emission coal plant.
Much more than I miss Robert Palmer himself.
And clean, safe nuclear energy. America is addicted to oil.
Surprised Bush doesn't call it Earl.
And everyone here tonight
he must have the right
to be proud of this record.
Wow. He must have worked on that for years before he got in the White House. You know, he probably had coaches going, oil, Earl, oil, Earl. Like I work with Ozzy. Adam, Earl.
Well done. How you
beautiful.
I twisted it up. Yeah.
Nice circle.
Yeah, it's good. That's why I get here early. I work those beats out early. I want to thank Dan Clark from Portland for sending that lovely ditty in.
Beautiful.
And
why should we do the work when our listeners can write the songs themselves? Right.
Well, I'm Rachel Perry, and that is the news for now.
It's time for Dave Damashek's number one sports. Number one, sports. Do it, Dave.
We are but 4 days away from the big game, Super Bowl 40, Steelers, Seahawks. Can't wait. First, I will say this. NBA last night, the big story there, West Coast dominance. The L.A. Kobes lay the pipe to the Knickerbockers at MSG. Kobe goes for 40. Meantime, Phoenix destroys the Sixers in Philly, and Ronnie Artest Kings whip the Nugs in Schwarzenegger. NHL, Gretzky's Coyotes dumped at home by the Canucks. But back to football. yesterday, the big media day where they where every media member save myself goes out and talks to every player on both the teams, and you know, fascinating stuff as always.
Sure.
You know, of course, these guys are wordsmiths. All
oh yeah,
the players. But the main story of the week, the 2 weeks, I should say, is I don't know if you've heard about this, but Jerome Bettis of the Steelers is from Detroit.
Hmm.
Have you heard that?
Hmm.
Wow.
Yeah. Hmm. If you know, little known fact.
Hmm.
I'm rooting for the Steelers. I love the Steelers, and I have had it with this story. Enough. Yesterday, Detroit Mayor Kwame Kilpatrick gave the bus the key to the city. And listen to this event.
Kwame Kilpatrick.
He's giving the key to our own. We claiming you. And I just need to let Seattle know, don't take it personal.
Amen.
We love you too. But we Jerome Bettis people in the city of Detroit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. I'm moving to Canada.
What gives?
I've heard enough.
And yeah, I mean,
here's the other thing too is imagine this is why it sucks to come from Los Angeles. If I ever made some Super Bowl squad in some other part of the country and we're playing at the Coliseum, you think the number one's Carolla returns to Los Angeles. Nobody gives a crap about anything over here, who comes from here or who leaves. By the way, I imagine almost half the guys in the NFL are from Detroit. That's the way I imagine it. What's the big deal?
Interesting point.
Returns home to play a game and then sets up shop in Florida for the rest of his life, right?
Yes, but I don't know if you know, though, that Jerome Bettis is from Detroit.
No!
I just want to let everybody know in Detroit that your native son is back home to win a championship. So root for me and make it truly a home field advantage.
All right, Bus. Listen, I'm starting to feel slighted as a fan of Pittsburgh, you know?
Yeah.
How about a little black and gold talk, you know?
How about it? Instead of just black and black.
What? All right. You're from Detroit. We get it. All right. Enough's enough already. There are 52 other guys on the team that are excited about the game, too.
Right.
Now, on the other hand, the Seahawks didn't come out smelling like a rose, in my opinion, either.
Mm.
Listen to Seahawks QB Matt Hasselbeck and this desperate, pathetic plea.
My plea would just be for all the people coming to the Super Bowl that are sort of undecided on who they want to root for. Root for us. You know, we could use it. Get loud for us. That's, you know, I don't know if anyone will answer the call, but.
Wow.
Well, what? Really? You have that little self-esteem? Please. Somebody cheer for us. Please.
We're good people.
We're playing, too. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I know Jerome Bettis is from Detroit, but. Please,
yes.
Somebody.
Sounded weak. You should be brimming with confidence, Shaq.
Yeah, it's really sad. And, you know, by the way, I wanted to make mention, you know, everybody has to weigh in on their opinion of this thing. And I can't wait to talk to Seattle Mayor Greg Nickels. I want to see if he's willing to put his money where his mouth is. I'm sure he's a great supporter of the Seahawks, of course. But
turns out he's from Detroit and wanting to move back there.
Yeah, Kwame Kilpatrick is making another key. He's forging another key as we speak to give it to him. But, you know, as it turns out, now, the latest prognosticator to enter the fray, Condoleezza Rice, Secretary of State.
Really?
While her boss man is coming up with the State of the Union, she's busy weighing the pros and cons of the Seahawks defense versus the Steelers offense. And as it turns out, she's decided she's going with the Steelers.
Really?
I don't know if I like that.
Condi ass. That's what I say.
I don't know if I enjoy that so much. But anyway, listen. 4 days away is the bottom line. Can't wait. Let's get this mayor on the phone and see what he's made of. That's it for me.
All right.
Dave Damashek's number one sports.
We have Greg Nickels, the mayor of Seattle. Is this his secretary who's on the phone?
No, this is the mayor. Good morning, Adam. How are you?
Hello.
Hello, your honor.
Thank you, sir.
You have been the mayor of Seattle for
just
4 years?
4 years.
Over 4 years.
Uh-huh.
Seems like a great town to be mayor of.
Well, thank you. It is. It's a wonderful place to live, and it's got a pretty good football team.
Yeah. So I hear, and it's got to be nice. I mean, 30 years of being in the league and not making it to the show, and now this year.
You know, I'm a Chicago native, so I grew up a Cubs fan. So 30 years is really nothing. We're pretty patient people here.
You do that standing on your head. I got to believe, I know you're probably too modest to take credit, although if I was mayor, I would run on this platform. My platform would be made of Seattle Seahawks planks. That would be it. Like, listen, you guys had 26 and change years before I got here dry. Then I come into town. Sure, it's going to take a few years to get the team on its feet. I had some changes to make, and now here we are.
I installed the West Coast offense.
Yes.
That should be your claim.
That's Dave Damashek from
Okay, let's keep that between us, and we'll work on it.
Number one sports man over here who's from Pittsburgh.
All right.
Yeah. Now, I'm not sure, and I know, be honest, Your Honor.
Yes.
You obviously have to wave the green and blue or whatever color that is you guys go with towel over there, but you're from Chicago. You really don't care about the Seattle team, do you?
Oh, no. I've been in Seattle since I was six, and
I
was six, we had no professional teams. We got the Sonics in about 1966, and then the Seahawks in 76 and the Mariners in 77. So, you know, you begin over time to lose those old allegiances, and particularly as my kids were growing up, and we started to clue in more on the Seattle teams. I bleed blue.
Are you going to the game?
Absolutely.
And do you have one of those cornball bets going with the mayor of Pittsburgh?
Yes, we do, as a matter of fact.
You do?
We're putting up some really good stuff, and then we're finding that there's some real interesting things from Pittsburgh.
How about, would it be funny if you just shocked the world and said, we're putting up a kilo of black tar heroin? Some of the best. This stuff straight from Mexico.
You know, we went as far as salmon and coffee and great Washington wine. And
what do they have over there in Pittsburgh? Some kielbasa?
That's exactly right.
That's nothing.
Iron City beer.
They've got an interesting sandwich, I guess it's called.
Sandwich.
I believe it's called Primanti's, Your
right.
Honor.
Primanti's deli has, what does it have?
Here's what they do.
You know what would be faster? Why doesn't Dave say what's not in a Primanti sandwich? It'll be faster. Yeah. Primanti's?
They put it on their nice grill. Any kind of deli meat you like, roast beef, corned beef, pastrami,
okay,
any of these.
Okay.
Then they take some nice provolone, they melt that right on top of it.
Yeah.
The grill,
oldest
time.
Cheese.
Right. Delicious. Yes. Then they take some coleslaw.
Mm.
Not the mayonnaise coleslaw, mind you, but the vinegar-based coleslaw. They put that on there. Delicious French fries.
Mm.
Then two nice thick cuts of Italian bread. They slap all that right in between there. It's the finest sandwich you shall ever have.
It's in it, the French fries.
Wow. In there and the coleslaw, all right stuffed in between the delicious Italian bread.
2,500 miles later, it is delectable.
Yeah, right.
I can't get the fries. I can't get the fries from the In-N-Out drive-thru back to my house without them going south.
I only wish, Mr. Mayor, you would get a chance to taste that sandwich, but of course it's a moot point because you'll be shipping off your delicious and delectable salmon to Pittsburgh, PA.
Okay, all right. I have a feeling that salmon is going to be swimming in Puget Sound a week from now.
Wow.
Happily.
Wow.
Let's you and I make a bet, Mr. Mayor.
Powerful words. How about it?
I'd say we make a bet.
Well, I'll tell you, I think I've got about everything that Pittsburgh has to offer on this list already.
Oh, yeah? What do you got to offer, Sheck?
Well, first of all, may I say, Mr. Mayor, that I think that's exactly the point. Your city is spectacular. Delicious food, beautiful scenery,
yes,
wonderful people.
Sky is
we don't
blue.
Have anything. You have enough in Seattle. We need the Super Bowl crown. Right.
Right.
Please, let us have something.
Well, you know, you've got your history.
Yes, you're right.
And you should enjoy that. You should embrace that and recognize that Seattle is all about the future. Future starts on Sunday.
But you understand, it is sort of like you have two prisoners. One of them is in lockdown. He's in the hole. He's in solitary confinement. The other one is out in the yard. He's conversing with other inmates. He's smoking. He's playing hoop. Now there's a video game. There's a Game Boy to give to one of them. And you want to give it to the guys out in the yard already in the sunshine.
Oh, now, wait a minute. We've never been to the World Series.
All right.
We've never been to the Super Bowl before.
True.
Our last NBA championship was 1979.
True.
When we beat the what was then the Washington Bullets.
Oh, yeah.
So I think that Pittsburgh has got the big yard with the...
All right. Maybe you're right. And here's I just want to point something out. Here's how little the WNBA means to the world. Even the mayor of the city who won the championship doesn't acknowledge it.
I was going to get to that.
No, I tell you what.
And we also had a co-national championship with the Washington Huskies. Co-championship. That's,
yeah.
You know.
That's like kissing your sister.
All right, Mr. Mayor, I'm going to say this. Here's our bet. $18,000.
Come on.
No? All right, how about this? I have it on good authority from the powers that be in the city of Pittsburgh. I've been given authorization to make this gesture to you. If Seattle wins it, we will change the city's name to Seaburg. But if the Steelers win, your city must be changed to Piddle. Deal?
Let me take it up with my people.
All right.
Please. Thank you, your highness.
Best wishes. I say this. I look forward to seeing you at the Super Bowl.
It's going to be a great game. And we're Pittsburgh, despite what you're saying, is a great city.
Yeah,
and,
I agree. Nicer. Here's why Pittsburgh's a great city, because your expectations are so low when you enter Pittsburgh, you're surprised.
Well, you know,
when you're not getting shot at the airport, you actually think, wow, this isn't as bad as I thought it was. It's like when somebody tells you a movie sucks and then you see it on the plane and you go, wasn't so bad. That's how Pittsburgh is. Seattle, beautiful city.
It is a beautiful city. But Pittsburgh.
All right. Forget about Pittsburgh.
It was one of the greenest cities I've ever been in. Of course, you know. I suppose during the winter that probably isn't the case, but it was a beautiful
the greenest phlegm, by the way. Your Honor, can you be a part of the show? Call in once in a while, give us a little report, because you know it's a big affiliate for us, Seattle, and it'd be awesome.
I would be very pleased to. You bet.
Yeah, we also have an experiment to conduct as well, which is we took wallets, put money in them, and dropped them all over Los Angeles. We put a, if found, call this number, and people return them.
Oh, that's excellent. Good.
Yeah, 5 for 5. I would challenge the great city of Seattle to go five for five.
You can't beat 5 for 5. What can we do?
Come Monday, it will be Piddle, by the way.
Yeah, the great city of Piddle. Well, we're going to have a representative work it out. But the point is there's many issues we need to talk to you about consistently. So if you could be part of our show, we would be honored.
I would enjoy that very much.
Thank you. The great Greg Nichols, mayor of Seattle.
Delight. I feel bad that we're going to have to the put a city down on Sunday.
Yeah. We will. The Piddle Supersonics. Wow. It's funny. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back after this.
You're listening to the new Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM.
That's right. 866-901-ADAM. Speaking of the phones, Donna.
Hi.
Are you upset about something Dave Damashek said?
No.
Oh, Dave, no. I think not. I think it was you. How dare you slam Pittsburgh like that?
Well, I gotta be honest. I'm trying to be honest. I've been to Pittsburgh once. I loved Pittsburgh. I was there for a couple of days doing some college speaking thing with Dr. Drew. And both of us spoke glowingly about Pittsburgh as we were leaving your fine city on an airplane and realized it's not nearly as bad as people make it out to be. People make it out to be horrible.
People expect there to be big black clouds looming over the city.
Yes.
That is so 1960s.
Yes.
I agree.
Yes. Steel furnaces belching coal dust into the air and, you know, overcast and all that kind of stuff. And it's really green and it's really nice.
Hilly.
It's hilly and green.
It's fun. It's a great, great party town, especially when the Steelers.
There's no better town in the world than Pittsburgh. Where do you live, Donna?
Well, actually, I live in Redondo now. But
shocker.
I am a Steelers
shocker.
Girl.
Shocker. Shocker. Why live that Nirvana? Why leave Nirvana and come here? I mean, look, everyone just do the math. There's a whole bunch of people living in Redondo Beach and San Diego and Seattle and Orange County are going to tell you how Pittsburgh's the nicest place in the world. Born and bred. Right. Then when you learn to walk, you left.
I'm not going to apologize to you.
Yeah.
No one has to. No one from Pittsburgh does. The Super Bowl team, ba 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 ba, we love you, Pittsburgh Steelers.
We need I had a nice, uncomfortable conversation with the good folks of DeKalb, Illinois, when they told me for the 55th time that Cindy Crawford, proudly, Cindy Crawford is from DeKalb, you know. You know, she's from this town. About the 65th time I heard that, I explained to them, she got her ass out of here as soon as she could walk. You understand? soon as she got her learner's permit, she was gone. The key is she doesn't live here now. She split. Anyone could be born anywhere. Where do you end up? That's how you should brag. You know, people do all that bragging. Oh, this guy's from here. Oh, this guy's from there. Yeah, where is he now? Here's what you should do. You should brag and go, this great athlete or this great actor or this supermodel, not from here.
But chooses.
Through her own volition, chose to lay down stakes here. Yes? How say you?
I regrettably say
Where do
yay.
You live?
Regrettably, I say yay to your thought.
Yes, you live here as well. Thank you. All right, you have a hard-hitting interview with another native.
That's right, I did.
Of the Pittsburgh area, do you not?
I do. Would you like to hear that?
Well, first explain who he is, because evidently people don't know the
There's
name Joe Montana.
If you know a lot about football, if you really are an intense NFL fan, they have this thing called the Super Bowl at the end of each year. It finishes it off.
Slow
the
down.
champion is declared. By virtue of who wins the so-called Super Bowl.
Can you put it in the dishwasher?
No, it's different. It's an event. It's not an actual bowl. It's an event, and each year they play it. And there's this one guy who was the quarterback of the San Francisco team who won it like three times. Right,
right. Little known guy. Perhaps the greatest star individual.
But a team sport, so you don't know the names.
But his name is Joe Montana, and he played a position called quarterback. He takes the snap. He has the football more than any other player. He throws it, you know. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I got a chance to sit down with the legendary 49ers QB and Pittsburgh native Joe Montana. Mm-hmm. And here's how that went. Joe Montana, how are you?
I'm doing fine. Looking forward to watching this game on Sunday.
I'm looking forward to it, too. But to this point in my very brief radio career, this is the pinnacle. Talking to Pittsburgh native, my fellow Pittsburgher, Joe Montana.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that very much.
Are you ashamed of what Jerry Rice is doing to the 49ers organization by dancing on television?
No. No, he's still hanging in there. If he would have gotten kicked out in the first round, I would say, yeah. But right now, he's still holding on. He's got a tough go from here, though.
You're a wonderful teammate. I'll say that much. It's been 15 years since you were on the field together, and you're still standing by his side in this embarrassing moment. So
always.
Good for you. Now, speaking of teammates, you know, it's been a while since you and Steve Young were on the field together. After all that was said about the rivalry there, who was better? Who was better?
Well, you're asking the wrong person because you know what my answer will be.
Go ahead and answer, because I talked to him last night. He said him.
Well, you know, some people have delusionary.
Did you really talk to this guy?
Yeah,
this is him.
All right, let's not look past. Let's look forward. Super Bowl 40. You're a Pittsburgh guy, born and raised in the cradle of quarterbacks. Yes.
Yes.
Well, now I can assume from that, though, that you're rooting for the Steelers on Sunday.
Well, yeah, I grew up a Steeler fan all my life, and, you know, I'm pulling for them, and, you know, I think they have an edge on the passing game side of it, and especially if they get ahead early. It's really tough for teams that have a stronger running game to come back, and even though there's a great runner in Seattle, but it's just a difficult road to hoe when you get behind in a game of that magnitude with just your running game.
All right, Joe. Listen, what a thrill it is for me to talk to you. You know, you're a Pittsburgh, one of Pittsburgh's favorite sons, you know, and it's a thrill for me to talk to you.
Thank you.
All right, good luck.
Thanks, take care.
All right.
Joe. Wonderful. Hard hitting.
Regular Joe.
Dave does some sort of mock interviews once in a while, and sometimes people have difficulty telling the difference between the two. Here's a rule of thumb. If it's not funny, it's a real interview. That's how you can always tell.
And if I was nervous. If I was talking to Joe Montana.
If it's marginally funny, it's probably cooked.
He had written all these funny questions, not one of those funny questions.
Oh, Broska, how dare you pile on?
I'm just saying.
He did a wonderful job.
He did a great job preparing. We went to lunch yesterday. He wrote all these funny questions. I'm laughing, and then I didn't hear one of those funny questions.
Hey, Broska, go back to not producing the show.
Whoa. All right. Nice work. We'll take ourselves a quick break. Big Ted is going to be in here to do the State of the Show address. He had a little meltdown last time we asked him to do it, but I think he'll be back and in fine form. All that after this.
You're listening to the Adam Carolla Show. Call Adam now at 866-901-ADAM and do it right now.
Yeah. Well, still more show to go. Can you believe it? Also, Broska handed me this card, producer Broska. Crack producer Broska. Damashek are feuding right now.
Damashek's got his hands folded.
He's angry.
Like a little baby.
He threatened to bury him with his verbiage. Don't make me mispronounce sandwich, he screamed at Broska. He handed me a card, and the card was upcoming guests on the show, and I thought, oh, is this going to be for the rest of it? Jimmy Kimmel's coming up, Gary Busey, Ron White from the Blue Collar Comedy, Potato Salad or something. Tad follows all comedians named after food. What's he called?
He's Ron Tater Salad White.
All right, and Tad's going to weigh in, and we're going to figure out whether he lost the 12.5 pounds and all. I thought, wow, that's a pretty full week. Not week, a day. This is tomorrow. Too much show.
Gary Busey. That's enough to cover a week.
Yeah.
Alone.
He is insane. And so we'll finish up this show, and then we got tomorrow to look forward to. Tad, by the way, if he loses the 12.5 pounds, and he had 8 days to do it, is going to go to the Rio All Suite Hotel. Sweet suites. And in Las Vegas, he's going to go there with the perfect 10 girls, and he's going to the VIP lounge over at Scores. It's going to be awesome. If. But if he loses, I get to shoot him in his big belly with a paint gun. And it sounds cruel.
It may not hurt him. May not hurt him.
He'll feel it, but he'll feel it 2 days later. It takes a while for the... It's like a tsunami. It takes a while for the shockwave to reach the coast.
It's like the fat guy who gets the bowling ball in the stomach.
Yes,
right.
You see it shaking. Right. Yes, right. Yes.
I've been preparing myself. I've been punching myself in the stomach because I don't think I'm going to lose this weight.
Good strategy. Yeah, rather than diet, just prepare yourself shot with a paintball gun.
No, I've been working out every day this week.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know...
How's the eating going?
I'm eating... You know, I'm not eating bad... But I'm eating like 3 meals a day. About it.
All right.
I'm not going to starve myself on this one.
No.
Which probably is my downfall.
Yeah. All right. Let's. This is punishment for me and your brother going to Vegas so many years ago. I'm still in shock. Let's hear a theme song before we get to Big Tad and the State of the Show address. Oh, new one.
An elephant and a rhino have in common, do you say? They both weigh less than this awful mess. The man they call Big Fat Tad. Yeah, he's fat, fat, Big Fat Tad. 90% lard, yeah, it's really sad. Fatter than old Star Jones. He'll probably spend his life alone.
Aww.
I'd be crying right now.
You that probably smells like ham. Adam threw him a
That's
bone.
That's very flattering.
And put Tad on his show.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, good.
Sad. AdamCarolla.com is where you go if you have any other Fat Tad songs. Or, you know, if you have a Fat Broska song or any song about how bad anyone sounds on the show but me, go ahead and go to AdamCarolla.com. All right, now it is time.
Yes.
Hours in the waiting and in the making. The president, of course, did his State of the Union last night. Big Tad has his State of the Show.
Yes, I've been... paying attention to the show for the past month. As everybody knows, we've been on for a month, and President Bush did his State of the Union, so I am going to do our State of the Radio address.
All right. Sure, it'll be silky smooth.
Yes, it will. My fellow listeners, The Adam Carolla Show is off and running, and the outlook for the show is good. But I'm not going to lie to you. There are some flaws. To start off, we need to remind producer Jimmy Bruska to turn off his mic when writing something down with a Sharpie pen.
Huzzah.
He's writing F off, Ted.
Also, we need to let Dave Damashek know that there are other teams out there besides the Pittsburgh Steelers who need some quality airtime. Also, it's Big Tad, not Fat Tad, you a-hole.
Wow.
Very presidential.
We do have some good times on the show, don't get me wrong. Mike Lynch, sound bites are sounding better than ever.
They really like that one.
Wow.
Rachel Perry, the news never sounds bad when it's coming out of the mouth of a beautiful woman.
Right. This is written before today's show, by the way. Just a heads up to everyone. It may be confusing to people at home.
Big Tad, hilarious as always. Thank you. Then there's Adam Carolla. What can I say?
Thank you. There you go.
Nothing but perfection.
Mm.
A radio talk show host who knows how to make people laugh and also push people's buttons at the same time.
Mm.
A man whose voice should not be heard in just 10 markets, but all over the world.
Mm.
He is the voice of freedom, and that is why the Adam Carolla Show is going to keep on keeping on, taking us to the mountaintop and beyond. The state of our show is strong. Thank you. God bless you. And may God bless the Adam Carolla Show.
Wow. Thank you. Nice work, man.
Thank you.
You're officially out of the doghouse. You're not into the main house. You're just in the yard between the doghouse and the main house. We'll see about letting you in after the weigh-in tomorrow.
Thank you.
All right. Well, time to give some thanks where thanks are due. I'm going to thank Rich Eisen for calling in, lead anchor on the NFL Network. Enjoy his work immensely. Matt Silverstein and Dave Jeser. Drawn Together, Wednesday nights, 10:30 on Comedy Central, along with Cree Summer. Wonderful show. I am blessed to be a part of it. David Guest turned out to be pretty good. Start off a little shaky, but then loosened up and had a good time with him. His biography's coming out in 2006, although I think he said 2007 there, Bruska. Seattle Mayor Greg Nichols is... his honor for calling in and being a good sport. Hopefully he'll be part of the show on a regular basis. President Bush for phoning in, as of course the great Frank Caliendo doing the voice. He's at the Crest Theater in Sacramento on Saturday, February 18th. Tickets are available now at tickets.com. And until next time, this is Adam Carolla saying mahalo. 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 Carolla say mahalo. Carolla say mahalo. Carolla say mahalo.